Oh, golan globies, peace sells, but something, something.
Who's buying? We ain't buying this movie we're doing this week.
Is this an Elvis and Costello bit? Wait.
What?
Elbit and Costello?
I thought you were going to say Elvis Costello for a second. This is an Elvis Costello bit, yeah.
Yeah. This is an Elvis Costello bit. Welcome back, everybody. Elvis and Costello here with another beautiful movie. Okay. Is there actually Dolph fans out there?
There are. I see them on the twits.
What? How? How?
I don't know how the Dolphins do it, because I've gone on record. I want to like him. He's a Swede. I'm Swedish descent. I want to like this guy. I don't hate him. I'll go that far. I don't hate Dolph. I don't get him. I don't. There's certain actors. Your mom's going to hate me for saying this. Kevin Costner's one of them.
Okay.
They're so bland that I think you can project whatever you want onto them.
They're like a living green screen.
Yes. Yeah, so okay. I think that's what some people like. I think that's Dolph fans are, because I don't see anything. When I see Dolph, it's just, he's wallpaper. He just blends in.
Yeah.
He looks
good. He's very much like, I'm trying to relate him to an NWA wrestler, but I can't think of
Hager,
one.
Hager?
Hager?
Is that his name? Jake Hager?
Oh, Jake Hager?
Big blonde guy?
Oh, yeah. I guess
so. Well, they have the same thing. They have no personality. That's what, I mean.
Oh, he's gone now.
This is the thing that, good. He has the look. Dolph definitely has a look.
He's
like 7 feet tall.
Yeah.
4 inches from the ground. We learned that from Little Tokyo.
Of course.
That's what he calls his dick, Little Tokyo.
Yeah.
But the thing, then there's Schwarzenegger. Schwarzenegger has charisma up the ass. He exudes it. Even though he's not a great actor.
No.
Dolph has no charisma.
Yeah.
Jean-Claude has charisma. You look at him, when he sees on the screen, your eyes go towards him.
He uses little baby words and everything. He says things like, you are not enough strong. But he works it over with his nice little styled hair to the side in every movie and his weird wardrobe and his Euro fashion. It works. But some reason with Dolph, they try to take him away from being the big heel that he was in fucking Rocky, and it never worked for us so far.
For us so far.
So far.
We were just talking about this. We did enjoy the Punisher movie.
Yeah, that was okay.
But the other ones we've seen were just like, we just don't get it.
He wasn't playful at all from what I remember in Punisher, though.
No, not at all.
He was a weird dude hanging out in the sewers.
Naked in the sewer.
Yeah. I'm all about naked sewer life. Yeah. And he had a fireplace.
He was a chud.
He was a chud. What was that stand for again?
Cannibalistic humanoid underground dweller.
One of Murray's favorite movies. I like that you brought up Arnold, though, because last week we went into the fact that we've been watching modern shit, and this is not a modern movie. This is a 70s movie. I had to wash the taste of this movie out of my mouth. So I watched a movie called
Hercules in New York?
I didn't watch Hercules in New York. He was uncredited in it, but yes, I am going to bring up Arnold. Yeah. He was in a movie called The Long Goodbye. Okay. Very good movie. Hard-boiled detective, you know, noir shit.
Okay.
Guys constantly waking up, smoking cigarettes. Like, I've never smoked in my life, but there's something about a detective.
He's got to smoke.
Like, at a rate where you're like, guy, you need to calm down. So there's a scene where he is being tossed into a mafioso house, and they're like, we're all going to get naked and tell truth right about now, because I need to know where my fucking money is. And then this giant lurking guard comes in the background, and I was like, I recognize that coiffed hair. How do you say
coiffed.
That? Coiffed hair. It's like, I'm pretty sure that's Arnold. So everybody starts undressing. Like, two people unbutton their shirts, and then the background is Arnold completely down to bikini briefs. I was like, yeah, that's fucking Arnold right there. It was beautiful. I had to go look it up on IMDb.
Is that just, he just came out in his briefs and then left?
He just undressed.
Very brief.
He had a very brief cameo. Well, not a cameo, because he wasn't a star yet. But yeah, it was very cool. I was like, hey, there's Arnold. Oh. Looking great with his... He had it that bowl cut almost, but he always, you know, tossed it to his side. So it wasn't like the
proto JCVD.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, that was my cool sighting. So anyways, movie, not so good. Not so good. But this is really hard for us because, I mean, Murray, we've been talking about some missives since Ilsa came out.
Yeah.
And our main characters in this movie, I mean, if you count Diane, too, she's a total simp for fucking our main character.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't get it.
And then you've got Dolph acting smug as fuck, and it's like, I don't get that because he doesn't pull it off very well. And then you've got his partner Smith, who's a complete submissive to fucking what's his
name?
Jake.
Jake Kane. Was he the inspiration for Agent Smith from The Matrix?
Yeah, definitely. You can tell. He reminded me of, oh God, I can't even think of his name, but he didn't have the same attitude from Twin Peaks, the smaller agent that's always given the Twin Peaks sheriff's shit.
Well, Smith is, I think the guy's name is Brian Benben. Mm-hmm. He was on, the only thing I ever saw him in, there was a show on HBO in the 80s called Dream On.
Okay.
Awful show.
Awful.
But it was one, you got to remember, this is pre-internet, so it was one of those shows where it was about a guy, like a boring guy like him, who would have these like fantasies, but you would see his fantasies.
Oh, yeah, okay.
So you would watch it because there'd be like 3 seconds of tits in the episodes. Because there's no porn,
it's those,
you know?
Days.
Yeah, those
days. We get
days.
3 seconds of tits in this movie.
So you just sit through it, we get more. They're ogling the one stripper in this movie.
Well, Smith is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jake doesn't give a shit. Well, have you seen tits before?
Have you seen tits before?
Good one. Nailed it.
Yes, I have.
Not like these. Wow, wee wah.
Yeah, because they were pretty rough, I thought.
They were very rough. Maybe that's why he was staring at him so long. He's like, yeah, man, it's like, breast surgeons just aren't doing it these days. Yeah, what year did this movie come out?
90.
90.
I saw this in the theater. Only thing I remember about it was the CD gun thing. The shoots out the bad guy's thing. That's basically it. I did not know this was a Christmas movie. If I'd known, we would have done this in December.
Yeah.
So, sorry, this is a belated Christmas movie. Now, here's the argument. Now, fuck Die Hard. I Come in Peace. I know the rest of our international people know it as Dark Angel, because the rest of the world, it was known as Dark Angel. Makes no sense. What the fuck? There is one angel in this movie we'll get to later. Assuming that's what they're referring to.
Yeah.
But the main line for the bad guys, I come in peace. It's a perfect name for a movie.
I know. I like that movie. I like that movie. I like that title. I thought it worked better. I mean, the only... Milhouse! Sorry. Got to keep her out of her crotch.
Okay. Stop eating your peach.
Exactly. Gross. I really don't like that.
Let me get the mic up to there. Can you hear this?
Oh, God. Okay. Oh, Jesus Christ. Where were we at now? God damn.
Talking
it.
About I Come in Peace.
I really like that name. The only thing, if anybody tells me if they walk away from this movie, remember anything about Dolph Lundgren's character, you're fucking lying to me.
I remember that he was gone for 8 days, and we'll get into that.
All right, Murray, let's move on. Oh, okay.
I want to point out also, because we don't do this. This is... Our show is very, if you know this, very stream of conscience. We don't plan anything. And there's a connection to this movie to our tippy tap we're doing next week.
Mm.
Because the guy who did the music for this, Jan Hammer, did the theme for Miami Vice. And we're going to be doing a Miami Vice tippy tap in the next few days. Look for it on Sunday.
Holy shit, that's awesome.
Yeah. So it's just... Yeah, there's connections. This is the QAnon of podcasts. There's so many connections.
Except we actually give you the connection.
Yeah,
we don't ask you to do the research. Yeah. We do it for you.
These are
everybody.
Real.
Murray, I need to ask you a very serious question. There's a couple serious questions happening right now, okay? So let's put on our serious hats, serious monocles and everything. Now, I have to say, this character, Jake Kane, despite his beautiful Scandinavian features, he's going to disappoint Ilsa. Jake Kane has small dick energy.
I thought you just said he was smug. That kind of negates the whole small dick energy vibe.
I don't think he could handle that pressure situation the same way Wolf did.
Do you think that's the same thing with his little Tokyo character?
Yes.
It's all a ruse?
I think it's all a ruse.
Well, usually the people that talk the most are the people who talk how good they are at fucking are usually awful. Mm-hmm.
No, it reminds me of a 13-year-old, when kids are just starting to, like, maybe feel out some women and everything, maybe touch a breast or two.
The sandbag.
Yeah, exactly. I feel like he's the type of guy who carried that into his early 45s and was like, I'm good with a few women. He's that guy. Oh. Dolph Lundgren.
I can't argue that. I think you're right.
So, despite... Ilsa would pull him out and be like, holy fuck, I'm gonna climb this mountain.
By looks, you go, this is the Aryan Superman
exactly.
that she was talking about.
And then when she undoes the pants and it flops out and hits the ground, you think she would be losing her mind. But then the disappointment and the fact that she's getting all the way up there. It's like when they tell you about Chick-fil-A and how good it is and you bite into it and you're just like, it's a chicken fucking sandwich.
I haven't had one, so I don't
that
know.
That is her Chick-fil-A. Dolph Lundgren would be her Chick-fil-A.
Dick-fil-A.
It'd be her Dick-fil-A.
Dick-fil-A.
All right, and let's bring it back to our character Smith and Jack.
She wouldn't
Kane.
Even need to castrate him. He has no balls.
Exactly.
All dick, no balls.
I agree with this. Yeah. That's why I came with the question. Yeah. Okay. One other question, cop-related. We're bringing it back. Last
cop-related?
Week. Cop-related?
Oh, there's a cop-related.
Cop-related. That's a new word.
Yeah, no, that means fucking. It's copulation.
Oh, really?
Copulation, yeah.
Oh. Coitus? Yeah. Oh, okay. So I'm bringing it back. We talked about a certain Tiger Cage situation last week.
Yeah.
And the creativity of cops, what the cops would do last week. We had the... a ball sack, shooting the tiger, of course.
Don't remind me of ball sack.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Shooting the tiger, of course. If you want to listen to us complain about a character for
two... He would hit the tiger with that fucking acoustic guitar.
Ball sack?
Yeah.
Well, we said he would shoot the tiger.
Yeah, he definitely would shoot
okay.
the tiger.
And if you want to hear us complain about a character for 2.5 hours, everybody, that's number one with a bullet for you.
Yeah.
And then, of course, Billy Dee Williams' character would soothe him with his little trombone mouthpiece.
Yeah.
Now, our characters, Smith and Jack Kane, what do you think they would do? I already know what Jack would do.
Jack, I think he would kill the tiger, I'm guessing. Do you have a theory?
Yes. Well, we just talked about his small dick energy.
Yeah.
I think, and you brought this up last week as well, I think he would capture that tiger, sell it to somebody who's willing to shave off the tiger's balls into some kind of ginseng tea.
Grind them up, yeah.
Grind them up. And give him the masculine energy that he needs to please Ilsa. I think he wants the ball serum.
Okay.
I don't know what Smith would do. He's a pansy, so...
I think Smith appreciates the beauty of nature, and he would say...
That would change him. That would be the catalyst for his life change, and he would be a good cop, or just quit the FBI altogether.
Well, he was a good agent. He always went by the book.
He did go exactly by the book.
Which is bad... When you're talking about the heroes we talk about, you never go by the book.
Yeah. Well, we also never go by a script, and we've yeah, dragged this out yeah. for very long. So what do you say, trailer time?
Let's hit that trailer. Let's get a little piece of I Come in Peace.
Houston, Texas. It's Christmas. Someone special is coming to town, and it's not Santa Claus. Jack Kane, a cop who does things his own way.
What are you doing? Shortcut.
He's sensitive,
hey.
Understanding, and kind to strangers.
Merry Christmas.
But all that's about to end.
I come in peace.
Three well-armed men have their throats cut before they can even draw their weapons. Who could possibly move that fast?
Aliens.
Say what?
Are you crazy?
It's true!
You need a psychiatrist, Jack.
Your psycho stole a lot of heroin to kill people with.
What are you gonna do? Tell them we're fighting drug dealers from outer space, huh? The human body carries a small electrical charge, right? You tune the disc to the charge and then...
What the hell is going on here?
As far as you're concerned, this case is closed. It's not our problem anymore.
I've had a bad day.
Lundgren,
and you go in pieces.
Dark Angel.
Make sure to cut all that out, by the way, because I don't want to have a commando thing again.
Welcome back, everybody. Me and Murray just been having a great talk about ending things on time, something we are not capable.
We'll do it.
We are the Olympians who, when they finish, we just keep going. Like, you plant the landing, you got a tent, but then we're just like, nope, we get a cartwheel now.
We're a marathon, not a sprint.
Exactly. Well, that's why we always tell people put the cath in. And fuck off to that one person who said you could pee and listen. I tried it. I tried listening to us while peeing. Murray.
You get like a little nervous. You can't pee.
I get a little nervous. Yeah. It's like you're yelling over my shoulder while I'm trying to pee. It doesn't work. And then I'm talking over me, and it's me talking to me while I'm peeing, and it just doesn't work.
Yeah, I don't do that, so yeah.
Yeah.
I don't pee when I'm listening to a podcast.
All right, Murray. Something you're very familiar with. You are the drive behind. I just saw the stats. The stats are out. I'm one of these stats guys. I read all the stats.
You are. We call him Analytic Griff.
Yep, Analytical Griff.
And it's really coming out because we hinted that he's a gambleaholic now.
I'm a gambleaholic. I've taken a week off.
He has a system.
I've had to take another week off because I had another bad week. I lost $20 again, so I'm taking another week off. I'm going to really focus my lucky chi. But Murray, what's important here, I have a website called griffsgraphs.com where I chart out all my analytics.
Look that up. Ignore that like everything we do.
It's nothing like you would think it was spelled. So... CDs, they're on the rise nowadays. You are the purge.
I'm the last person to buy CDs still. Yeah, I just like holding something in my hand.
That's why.
I kind of admire you that you want no possessions.
No. I collect the vinyls for the albums
I
really
love. Yeah, but
still,
that's like, you know, I'm like a hoarder basically.
You
now.
Are. No, you are 100% a hoarder. Yeah. Like, it's disturbing. Yeah. When I go into your house, I'm disgusted. I don't even flip through your shit because
I'm
like...
too much. You'll be exhausted. That's my plot. Like, you'll be so tired that you won't do it.
You really haven't figured out because I look with just my eyeballs in your place because it's too much shit. It's disgusting.
Got like 10-year-old newspapers piled up. Yeah.
Oh,
so got like this little walkway go through.
Oh, my
yeah,
God.
But I just like... I don't know. I'm also... an album guy. I'm not like a lot of kids now are single people.
I hate it. I hate the single.
Well, that was like, but that was originally what music was in the old days.
It was
the singles.
I always hated it because when you buy a fucking album for a single, it is such a burn. When it's like, I worked my ass for the $10 to get this fucking CD and it sucks balls. The Vines, the first band that scorned me, spurred me, whatever word you want to use.
Yeah.
I bought that album.
You.
Betrayed me, sure.
Yeah.
I bought that album. I was like, oh, my God, I can't wait. It fucking sucked. Next album I bought, The Hives. And I was like, fuck yes. This is what it's all about right now.
Okay.
So we're CDs? Talking CDs. Yeah. Because our mate, nobody.
This is 1990, dude. I didn't even, I was listening to cassettes in 1990.
Yeah.
I was like, no, I don't need
CDs. Well, this guy points it out. He's got a $70,000 CD system in his car.
70,000. I call bullshit on that. I mean, was he driving a Cadillac? It was probably a Cadillac.
He was practicing for when he's showing off.
Adjusted
for
inflation, and actually being serious, that would be like $150,000.
What streets are we on right now?
We're in Houston. I thought this was L.A.
This is Houston?
This is Houston, yeah.
It very much looked like L.A. because there's a scene on the streets later where it's a church and then a strip club and then a highfalutin bar and then a liquor store, which in Houston, that wouldn't be a thing. It's a blue chip state. They don't have liquor stores open past a certain hour.
Really?
Yeah.
Even in 1990?
Even in 1990. No, it's been that way. When I go down there, it's like, holy shit, it's 8 o'clock. We got to get to the liquor store now or we're not going to have any drinks.
Mm.
That's the thing.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
I thought all Texans were drunks. I didn't know that.
They are. It's because
they
have
get drunk before 8.
But no, they stock up at home before
That's even better. That helps society.
Yeah.
Binge drink. Don't just get it whenever you want to go
get it. Binge drink in your home where the guns are.
Yeah.
I mean, you can still drink at bars and everything.
So this guy, he's got like, it's like mahogany, the console.
It's beautiful.
And he's just putting in a CD. He's got the latest.
He kissed it. It was the latest Chuck Mangione.
Oh, was it? Yeah. I thought it was the Black Album. This is 1990. It might be like, this is the real good Metallica shit.
Maybe if he picked up like a rocker chick, he'd put that in there. Because you know everybody had the Black Album. Right. That's when Metallica got good. Right. Finally. We'd all have been waiting.
Figured it out.
Ugh.
So he puts it in, and then it spits out, like it shoots out.
It started feeding like a tape. It was like... that was not a CD thing at all.
No, but the CDs were relatively... They weren't new, but they were relatively new in 1990.
I don't know.
They were new to me. I never had one.
They were confusing the audience at that time, but at this time, we all know when CDs skip, you hear like an audible click. And then finally the music starts again.
Yeah.
So
he's driving. And like we pointed out, this is a Christmas movie. So something like shoots at his car.
Mm-hmm.
So he loses control, crashes into a Christmas tree lot. Do people get Christmas trees anymore?
Yeah. I saw them all up and down the street.
Really? Because not in my neighborhood. Everyone's plastic.
Well, fucking Christ. Real Christmas trees cost money. So you have to really fork it up. They're probably like $100.
Shit.
Yeah. So no.
He crashes in a lot. He doesn't know what's going on, so he gets out. It's like, goddamn $70,000 car.
I hate this fucking holiday.
And then, boom, his fucking $70,000 car bursts into flames, explodes.
And we get, from the ashes rises a character, and it was very hard to figure it out. But, guys, I did the hard work. I did the sleuthing. Yeah. This is a character named Talik.
He's never Metallic,
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Never referred to by name ever in this movie, but they do have names.
Yeah, and he's got a very angelic voice
darkly angelic voice.
Well,
I mean, he utters the most four chilling words you're ever going to hear.
I bring you peace.
So after you hear that, you're at ease, even though this guy is a hulking giant.
Yeah.
Played by Matthias Hughes, who's no stranger to Golan Globus Theater, people. He fought our boy Lauren Avedon in No Retreat, No Surrender 2.
Way, he did? Yes. I got Highlander vibes off him.
No, he was not in Highlander.
Because of the white hair and the white eyes.
Yeah. No,
very creepy looking?
Well, that's what they were going for.
Yeah.
So he's like 7 feet tall. He's got giant Herman Munster boots on.
Loved it.
Got the fucking long flowing white mullet.
Rockstar hair.
And he just puts he says that line, puts the guy at ease, and then he just shoots the fucking.
Did we see this?
I don't know if we did.
I don't remember if we did. I was alluding. Trying to skip over it because I was
just
like, I don't
we
remember.
Just cut to I Come in Peace.
Yeah,
because even though I looked it up on YouTube under Dark Angel, it said I Come in Peace. We're watching I Come in Peace.
Oh yeah. Anyways, we're cutting to a nice little heist in progress, and we've got Hawkins being pulled into it. So here's the thing. This is very confusing. I'm remembering this now as I'm trying to read through the notes. We're introduced to characters that do not get names.
No.
We have no idea what's going on. It's very cold here.
You knew how hard it was to take notes on these movies.
Yeah, it's fucking awful. And so what we're watching right now is a situation where these people are breaking into a police precinct.
Yeah, one guy.
One guy, but he had a second guy with him.
Yeah, he had an accomplice, but he wasn't with him.
Yeah, yeah, okay. So one guy's going in through the vents. The other guy is, like, trying to lure a guy into the evidence locker he was trying to get into. Was that what it was? Or just a closet?
No, it was an evidence locker.
Okay.
Or evidence room, I should say.
And so they're calling out for Hawkins is what I was
right, they call to a cop named Hawkins and say, hey, we need you in the evidence room, room J28, I think it was.
Sure.
While that's going on.
We get that detail right. Everybody.
While that's going on, we're seeing the other guy who broke in the air duct system. He's welding through like this grate.
Blowtorching.
Why is there this grate in this evidence room to begin with? I don't know.
The good ventilation for that. You got to keep the coke good. No.
Well, we learned this is heroin. This isn't coke, but.
Okay. And
when we see a bag full of white powder, we always go to coke. But no, this was heroin.
And you were impressed by how they packaged it, unlike last week.
Yeah, last week infuriated me. Yeah. You don't put coke in a Ziploc baggie, half-full Ziploc baggie at that. No, that's what you put your fucking Kool-Aid in there if you're a poor kid and you can't afford Lick 'em Sticks.
And, of course, if you're a devotee to this podcast, you know Murray is a stickler for packages.
Is that a euphemism for anything?
No, not at all, Murray.
Okay. So, yeah, I was very impressed with how it was packaged. Yeah. It was taped up, very Miami Vice.
Okay.
But anyway, so...
Hawkins arrives in J-28.
Hawkins with... Bad, cause these guys weren't given names, so this might be confuse you guys. Because goon number two, I'm going to call him.
Yeah.
They go to with Hawkins. They go into the room. They catch the guys who are thinking, aha, they caught this bad guy.
Yeah.
No. Other goon number two is with goon number one.
And he fucking opens up a nice little pocket knife.
It was a switchblade.
Switchblade.
Gotta have that moment. Okay. If we don't have the John Woo butterfly,
of course.
You gotta have the switchblade.
You gotta. And of course, you get the knife to the heart. Right. And you're to blame. You give love a bad name.
Right.
Sticks him in the heart with it. And of course, just like we always talk about, that makes you mute. Soon as the knife penetrates your chest, you go mute.
Had to kill this cop because he needed the little gold badge that said Hawkins on. He couldn't have made that.
Yeah.
They have cop uniform. The guy's wearing a cop uniform.
He's wearing a perfect uniform.
But he couldn't put it together, just get the little name tag.
Yeah.
So that's why they murdered a guy. So they got their Kinji Tashie case out. They put in all the horse.
Yep, the
put
horse.
Put it in there, and they walk right out. Because they're like, we're cops. I got the badge.
I was having the hardest time because they have to talk to the guy at the evidence locker. And right. I was like, this is a very important scene. This is going to come back later. This scene plays no relevance. The fact that it has more than a second screen time, them just scribbling a name.
Well, we had to see that the one cop at evidence room was suspicious of these guys. Because he saw that. He goes, I know Hawkins, and that's not Hawkins.
Yeah.
That was all it was.
He really was. And let's go ahead and... Like, we've planted this little seed in these people's heads that this guy is going to alert everybody to these misdeeds. But as they walk out of the building, they leave a little package behind.
A little duffel bag.
Yeah. Our slicked back white hair, white right, boys.
Yeah. The gang is called the white boys.
The gang is
We're not being
called
racist.
The, white boys.
The gang is called the white boys.
Yeah, we didn't call them crackers. It's okay. Right, they're white boys.
Get in the car, and then one guy's like, hey, what was that bag you left? I left a little present for them. And then as soon as he says that, boom, the whole police station explodes.
Why did we need the scene with the evidence guy and his suspicion being arisen if he's just going to explode?
Arisen, I think is what you're
meant. Arise.
I don't know, but the one guy's like, holy shit, what the fuck are you doing? Got to cover our asses.
He had a good evil laugh. I murdered them all. That was it. Yeah.
So now we just set up our bad guys, but not really, because these guys don't really matter at all.
I see a correction we got in here that you helped me out with because we're finally cutting to our quote unquote hero of this movie.
We got Dolph. He's doing a stakeout because that's how you introduced your heroes.
And when you think about stakeout,
I think about peppers.
Ooh.
And when I think about peppers, I think about the nose. A little of the quiz. He's just noshing on this giant Quiznos.
I wish this would have been the week we got to separate from Quiznos, but here is Dolph Lundgren with the full pepper bar spread across his dashboard. He's supposed to be staking out. Come on, finger-friendly food.
He's camping out. He's just ready to stay there.
Here he is with this, what was it? It was an Italian, I believe. I saw the mayo. I saw the
Can't have an Italian without some mayo. Where are you? Come on.
I'm a heathen. We already know this.
This is like everyone knows in Italy they put mayo on their fucking Italian subs.
This is why I haven't gone to Italy yet, because I'm just afraid everything they have is just going to be like...
They love their mayo.
And your smear of mayo. Right. Yeah. No.
I like mayo. But so, he's got the wire. He's listening to what our evilest white boy, Manning, Victor Manning.
This guy looks great as a villain, by the way.
And he's all about higher education. That's all he's talking about is college.
Yeah.
And he's like, you know, I majored in communications, but that was going to go nowhere, so I switched to business. He's talking to this black guy who's just like, can we just get this deal done?
Yeah.
And he's just like, hold on a minute, hold on. I just want to talk about education.
Yeah, he's trying to have a good time. Oh, what did you say your name was again? And fucking, we'll learn this guy's name is Ray. Ray hasn't figured out his undercover name yet, so he's like, it's Luke
Well, we
Perry.
Don't know he's undercover. We just assume
okay,
he's a
I know.
Drug
I'm
dealer.
I'm letting people in on the secret a little bit. I'm sorry. The secret sauce is mayonnaise on an Italian sandwich. This guy, you can see him struggling. He's like, yeah, my name is Luke Harry. He's watching fucking Beverly Hills 90210. It's on in the background. It's 1990, of course. Yeah. It's everywhere.
Right, it was everywhere.
And so Manning...
He had the sideburns.
Manning, yeah, he did have the sideburns. And so Manning's just like, oh, Luke, of course, I remember Luke.
It's like, all right, let's get his shit. So now we see our boys from the earlier blew up the cop station.
White boys.
This is how great these guys are. They don't even use their own heroin for deals. They use the cops' heroin.
That's amazing. Talk about fucking profits. I mean, right. I mean, I'm playing with house money. Murray still is like, oh, you're going to be sucking dick in no time. No, I'm still playing with house. These guys are playing with cop money. That's right. Even better.
So it's probably it was their shit that was confiscated, and they stole it back.
I don't even think it was. I think it was a rival gang, and they went in and stole it because they knew about the rival gang going under because they have ears on the ground.
So they pull it out, and our boy Ray, he's keeping it undercover. He knows what you do. You pull it out, and you sniff the bag.
Here's the problem with Ray, though, and here's how I knew immediately he was an informant. He's feeling the bag. Perfect packaging. He's saying this out loud, everybody. Perfect packaging. No duct tape. I love that. Can I do a knife test? Okay. No drug dealer goes into this much detail. He sticks the knife in,
He doesn't even do that. He sniffs the bag.
Sniffs the bag. Yes.
That's what I was expecting that. I was expecting pulling out a switchblade, sticking it in, and doing a little like line. No, he just sniffs the bag.
But the thing is, we all know you don't communicate any of what you're seeing. You do it all while sneering at somebody. Like, maybe a little leering as well. But you're just saying everything with your eyes, but Ray doesn't understand this. Or I should say Luke Perry doesn't understand this.
Right. Then we cut back to our boy. He just finished the quiz. He's chunking down a Monster Energy drink.
He's getting a little bit of feedback on his mic. It's a little bit of that Max Headroom. Weird shit. He's like, oh, come on, man. No, he's slapping his radio, and he starts getting in it again. But then he sees a couple of fucking no-good idiots. Guy's got a fucking
Michael Bolton?
Michael Bolton.
Yeah, balding mullets. They got army jackets. They're no good. You know, he can tell immediately they're up to no good. But he's like, he could have just called. He's got a radio. He could have just called in. Hey, there's a robbery happening. I'm doing something right now. I'm staking out something. Something's about to go down right now.
My partner's in a very serious situation.
But no, he's super cop. Like you said, he's like, I got to prove I'm the hero. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to leave my partner to possibly die so I can be the hero right now.
Exactly.
So the guys come in. They immediately start shooting their shotguns off, telling people to go fuck themselves. Where's the fucking money? And then our hero, in quotations, walks in, and you just see a roundhouse kick just take out one guy.
Can you find me a more unbelievable roundhouse kick than Dolph Lundgren's? I'm sorry, everybody.
I think he had legit martial arts background.
How they shot this did not sell it for me.
Okay.
All right. So, sorry.
Takes the guy out.
Saves the day. Gets himself a snow cone. He's like, now that's what I call justice on ice.
Well, there's like a standoff because one guy's got a shotgun. He's got his fucking handgun.
Oh, okay.
And he just shoots the guy right in the fucking forehead. He's like, doesn't even care.
Oh, I didn't even care about the scene. You wanted the details in there. I wanted the snow cone line. I thought that was good.
So he did help himself to a snow cone.
Yeah. But next door we see all hell's broken loose because the white boys have come in. They figured out Ray is not – well, they figured out Ray is not Luke Perry.
Yeah, like we knew all this week because we knew that this week's Beverly Hills 90210 was a rerun. And you said it was a fucking new episode.
That's what it was?
That was the tell.
That in the order of the pasta fagioli, and you don't pronounce it that way.
Right, and he said, no mayo, and they said, something's up.
Yeah, something's up.
When you're in an Italian restaurant, you always could ask for mayo on the side at least.
At least. You have to do that. Like, you say, I have to watch my figure, you know, because
I mean, even when they give you the bread, they got the mayo you can dip it in, you know?
I don't get that. Like,
it's European. You're just too American.
Well,
you eat an Olive Garden. This is a real Italian. It's authentic.
That's why I'm confused that Italians like the marinara and stuff or the bruschetta. No, it's mayonnaise. Yes. Like, I get that wrong.
Mayonnaise, as they say.
Mayonnaise?
Yes, mayonnaise.
Oh, I've been learning from the Smashing Pumpkins song, and they say it differently.
So they just fucking shoot Ray.
Yeah, they shoot Ray in the head. Luke Perry, Jake has finished his robbery next door.
Right.
He's like, oh, fuck, shit's happened next door, so he just barges in, and he's finding that there's just dead bodies everywhere, because in the inner room of all of this,
Talik showed up.
Uh-huh, and of course he says his favorite line.
I bring you peace.
I'm starting to think this guy doesn't come in peace.
I don't think so at all, because he immediately starts shooting fucking CDs at people.
Oh, my God.
And I love it. It was literally a CD. Like, they didn't even try to, like, mock it off.
No, you can see the RCA label on it.
Yeah, and it was, like, it was scratched, though. And it's just, like, zoop, 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 going, like, it's slash and throw. It's just hitting everybody. It's, like, ricocheting off shit.
So they're implying to the audience that this CD, it's so destructive, as soon as it touches you, it's fucking tearing you apart.
Right.
So keep that in mind for later. Just put it in the back of the skull for 9 hours when we get to the end of this movie.
And then Jack arrives. Dolph tries to muster up some tears, some emotion, but he has no soul.
He's got nothing.
So it's pretty weak. And then this is where the backup arrives. We see the captain, who's always exasperated with our hero.
I like how they casted the captain, because we've had a lot of bald captains recently. This guy's bald, of course, but he's got the horseshoe, and he's got a little bit of that, like, the rainbow connection, as I like to call it. So you have the island, and then you have, you know, the peninsula up here.
That's an isthmus.
Excuse me?
Isthmus.
The isthmus. So he's got the gnarly isthmus where it's like flowing out and everything. This guy looks like he is disheveled.
He looks like a pencil pusher.
He works 18-hour days. Everybody's on his nerves. He's got coffee mainline. So I like the captain here.
Well, he comes up to Dolph, Jack,
who's at the bar, just like brooding over his, you know, loss.
And he's like, "Where have you been? It's been 8 days, 7 days I'd be okay with." He actually says that. He's like, 7 days I would accept. 8 days is beyond the pale. Where the fuck have you been?
Is Houston not in America, by the way? If you miss one day, because back in my delinquent days, I would just not show up for work sometimes. And no, after like 1 or 2 days, they'd be like hitting you up nonstop. This captain's kind of fucking progressive, where he's like, "I get a whole fucking week off."
Well, he knows that Jack plays by his own rules, and he gets results.
Yeah.
So 7 days is his limit. Yeah. But eight, no. I don't care what results you get.
You can't do eight. At least you got to hit him up on his beeper.
Exactly.
Okay.
And he's just like, "Buddy, much like last week, you're going on vacation. Yeah. You're not suspended. You're going on vacation."
Yeah. It's got to be forced on you, bud. I got to do this to you, Tyke.
And we learn that, of course, our hero never takes a vacation because he's dedicated to his job. Much like Ballsack from last week. And he's got a vendetta against a drug lord, much like Ballsack from last week.
So it's looking like we're going to have a long, heated conversation, but thank God the fucking feds arrive. And you never want to see the feds arrive.
No.
You want to keep everything
local.
Deep
state.
Exactly. They're the deep state. So they show up, and they're like, "You said you had a guy who saw all this? Okay. We want to talk to him in the bathroom." Fonz, of course, is in there. They're like, "Please, Mr. Fonzarelli, can you clear out?" "Yes, of course." They get in there. They're just like, "You know Manning?" "Oh, I know Manning." They think he's involved with this somehow. I don't remember how. But Switzler is the main FBI guy.
Switzer, yeah.
And so Switzler's just like,
you keep adding an L for some reason. It's a Switzer.
A Switzer, he's like, is that a kind of play on like Dolph's origins? Switzer?
He's not from Switzerland.
Oh, he's not from Switzerland?
He's from Sweden.
Oh, he's from Sweden? Sweet. Wait, they're different?
Yeah, they're different countries.
Oh, okay. I don't know my geography. I fuck up the geography category in Jeopardy all the time.
I believe it. And Switzer is like, "Look, I can just tell by the cut of your jib." Was he wearing a suede jacket?
A Switzer?
No, Dolph.
No. Dolph is wearing a cut-off jean jacket.
Oh, I'm talking about later. Remember that brown jacket? Was that suede?
It was suede.
Too soft.
Ooh, suede on the inside.
Badasses don't wear suede. That's too soft.
Yeah, that's for Anderson Paak.
You wear leather.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so he's like, "I can tell by the way you dressed. You got cowboy boots on, ostrich. I know you play by your own rules."
Oh, yeah.
"And we need somebody like that. I'm going to talk to your captain. You're back on the case, buddy.
We're going to get you back on this fucking case." They go back out, and fucking Dolph is smiling. He's just got this huge grin on his face. And he's like, "These boys tell me I'm back on the job. I told you you were going on vacation, but you never said when." Fucking
sick
slam
burn.
Dunk.
Oh my God.
You know, Dolph missed out on the Twitter age, because if that was the greatest Twitter dunk of all time.
Yeah, I just got dunked on by somebody. I'm using quotation marks on dunked on.
This dunk is fantastic. This is the best duck ever.
Do you want me to go through the whole story?
Please, the 18-minute story.
So when we did Big Trouble in Little China, I put up a tweet. They had the picture of the three storms, the henchmen for Lopan, and I said, the three storms.
Here, let's remember, we love timelines. This was 2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago. Well, it depends on when they're listening. It might be, should be listening.
2 weeks from when we're recording this. January 8th.
I said the three storms, great henchmen or the greatest henchmen. And agreed with me.
The old Colbert line. I love it.
And everybody agreed with me, but one guy.
Everybody has to have a one guy.
One guy, I have no idea. I don't follow him. He doesn't follow me.
How did he?
He has 22 followers following 500 people.
You don't have to pull rank.
I am going to pull rank.
Oh, okay.
Because he needs to know his fucking place.
Because he listens now.
Because you should listen, motherfucker. Because I'm going to teach you. I'm going to school you right now. So he goes, actually, Oddjob from Goldfinger is the greatest henchman. And I go, this is a young Padawan learner, and he doesn't know any better, so I'm going to go easy on him. So I even gave him a like. I said, I'm going to let him know that I'm just kidding.
I like that, because we are all about the playful conversation.
Right. We're not evil people. We're the most generous people. Who else ask listeners to come on their show? Nobody. Everyone wants the spotlight. We're not afraid to share the spotlight.
Oh, for fuck's sake. I mean, come on. People send us all these gross letters, and then they ask me to whisper into an envelope and send it back to them, and I oblige.
Yes.
Like, what is that?
Yeah, but please, self-addressed stamped envelopes, people. Yeah. We're losing money
here.
If
you want me to whisper back, please.
At least have the decency to do that.
Yeah.
We don't have time for this shit.
Okay.
So, I said henchmen. Not hench, man. Cut to a week later. I get a gif of Justin Timberlake like shaking his head, like rolling his eyes. I ignore. I said, okay, I'm gonna be the bigger man. I'm not gonna pull rank.
You're
right.
Ilsa approved man.
Yes. Super the Ubermensch. I said, am I going to? And then, like a day later, he likes his own burn on me. And I was like, okay. I should have liked it after that, but I just let it go.
It would have been funny if you.
But yeah, so thanks you for my little tangent there. Okay. All right, getting back to the movie.
So Dolph has dunked on his own captain by saying, I didn't tell you when I was going to take vacation, right. Bro. Sorry, he's a bro now. I can't do voices.
I agree. But here's the kicker. You're on this mission, this case, but you got to have a partner.
Yeah, so this is the FBI people telling them about
this.
You're going to be teamed up with one of the FBI's finest.
Special Agent Smith. He closes every case. He crosses the T's, dots the I's. This guy is the best of the best.
And so cut to the morning, and we're in the police headquarters. And he's there with his captain, and he's arguing with his captain. I'm so glad to be back on this case. He's like, oh, yeah, but here's your partner coming in now. And they cast this guy on purpose.
Yeah.
Dolph is 3 feet taller than him.
Yes.
And Dolph is – they constantly put him in scenes where they're not kind of far apart. They're claustrophobic shots where Dolph is looking straight down at him.
Yes. Literally and metaphorically.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, who's this? Of course, we get the scene, I work alone. Because all badasses work alone. They have time for partners. Except when they get their partners killed.
Yeah. He worked with Ray, and he got his partner killed. So is that his thing? He's gonna get his partner killed
right, so
he can work alone again.
I didn't think that was something that the Smith said. He's like, oh, is that because you get your partners killed all the
time? He did. And then Dolph told him, strike one, buddy.
Yeah.
He's keeping strikes. They get the three strikes like 10 minutes later, and all he does is like say,
no,
like,
he gets his strike one, and we get two and three like an hour later.
Oh,
like,
okay. Yeah. So they actually did. Okay.
Yeah, but two and three come very rapid
that's
succession.
That's long-term storytelling.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. And they're like, of course, the nerd Smith's like, let's go to ballistics and check out. Let's see what the body.
This is the first time we don't get rank the pedigree of Jack. We get the pedigree. Smith starts bragging about himself. I've read every detective book. I know all about Philip Marlowe. And I got to tell you, I solve cases. And, of course, Dolph is not impressed. He starts getting in his face. He looks straight down at him. And that's when Diane breaks the scene.
Diane, who we can – there's some tension between Jack and Diane. They're no longer sucking on a chilling dog at the local Tasty Freeze.
Never mind. Whatever we open this episode with, no, it's being replaced with a little ditty about Jack and Diane.
And Yeah, she's like, I got the ballistic report. This weapon, I don't know what the fuck it is. It's a, I don't know what slash these guys throw. They didn't find any evidence. They just all slashed throats. Like, there's no way one guy could slash the throat of fucking five guys.
Yeah, there's no way. The ballistics just don't add up. I went there and I looked at the scene myself.
And then she just slaps Jack in the face.
Well, they start walking, talking. And we keep, like, the captain said something about him and Diane as well. And now we're walking out, and Jack's trying to talk to Diane. He's like, look, there's a little ditty. And she's like, no, it's not a little fucking ditty. You should call. And she slaps him in the face.
And he's like, chili dogs? And then she just walks away.
Like, and that's when Smith gets his first strike, right? Because he says, like, uh-oh, somebody's got a hot date.
That's strike one.
Ugh.
Cut two, an abandoned school?
I mean, that's what it looked like to me. Okay, it was fenced off and everything.
Some kind of abandoned building. We see a lot of disgusting homeless people vomiting, fucking, shitting, doing drugs.
You thought it was awful?
Yeah. Well, homeless people are awful. Don't we know that? And so then we see a woman. Hard on, she's just down on her luck. She's just coming there to sleep it off.
We're really working up this whole scene. Let's just fucking power through.
No, but then what happens is, see, we point out that the aliens, just they're human spaceships. They don't have ships. They they're like meteors.
They couldn't afford the special effect to show like a wreckage of a tiny little ship, capsule, anything.
So we just see a big hole burned in. It's like almost like they come by the way Terminators come, where there's just this big electrical globe that just burns shit.
That would have been cool.
No, we don't get that. We just get a hole, a smoking hole.
Yeah,
and then we see another guy. What's his name? Aztec?
It's in there. Azek.
Azek.
Which is even harder than Aztec, because when you look at those letters, your brain immediately jumps to Aztec.
Apparently, aliens have male pattern baldness, too, because he's rocking a skullet.
No. He's got a new breed of haircut. The new breed should have had this haircut, because he just has the frontal lobe
shaved
over.
Didn't Kane cut his hair like that?
Excuse me?
Kane the wrestler.
No. Kane had flowing.
I know, but when he took it off and he was bald, I remember like the front half being shaved completely bald, and then the back just being stubble.
Maybe, because I wasn't watching it that time. I was there for the early age.
I remember seeing that.
That Inferno match fucked me up.
So, yeah, the front half of his head is bald, and the back is party time.
He doesn't say I come in peace, so we know this guy's a villain.
Exactly.
All right, so we're back at that club where the crime scene happened, next to the liquor store, or a party store, as we know it up here in Michigan. And they're discussing their own tactics. So this is a good scene. This is an important scene. We see like that they're two different types, you know. They're an odd couple, if you will. Right.
We learn that our man Jack, as all great heroes, go by their gut. They have no time to read. It's like, if I don't feel it in my gut, it's not real. And Smith, the opposite. He's like, I only believe what I read.
So, Murray, this is a very important scene, because this is when Smith pulls out a measuring tape.
Yes, that's the first thing we see. The scene opens with a measuring tape.
And it's of course, a perfect measure. It's the good measuring tape, the one you want to have for most jobs. And so it, like, can stand sturdy for, you know, several feet or whatever. And he pulls it out for 4 inches, and then this camera just freezes on that for some reason.
Yeah.
And it's like, why did it just freeze on? He's not even holding it to anything except his crotch.
We didn't see what happened earlier. He was holding it to something. They're having a good old-fashioned dick measuring contest. Yeah. They're like, just saying, who's the alpha? We're deciding. We're figuring it out.
And so Dolph, of course, pulls out his fabric measuring tape.
Yeah.
And he just lets it flow. And it hits the ground, and we slowly climb up.
It's almost a midnight thud.
It's almost a midnight thud. 1 inch, 2 inch, 3 inch. And it's like the fucking the Price is Right game, the yodeling game. Yodel, yodel,
yodel. It was a little yodeler going up the dick.
And he's going up the measuring tape.
And he's like, I guess we're even. 4 inches too, but mine's from the ground. And then Smith just his disheartened look on his face. And then,
what do you think we should do, big guy?
We follow my instincts. Instincts? There's no founding in science. Science is for nerds. You don't read. You see, you ever been in my bathroom and there's magazines? They're not for reading. They're for wiping my ass when I run out of toilet paper.
There we go. There we go.
I don't have time for your nerd shit. And then he's and then they're like, well, what are we gonna do? He's like, I gotta get a drink or something. I need to think. I need to get away.
Yeah, he's like, I know exactly where my heart's pulling me. So they do this thing in this movie because the boring parts are the Dolph parts. The good parts are the alien parts.
Right.
They're the good part of the movie. That's why when you walk away from this movie, all you care about is the fucking aliens. They got great hair, weird hair.
Rockstar hair.
They got weird instruments that they use. I can't wait to see them bust out. What's another? Janet Jackson album or something. So we're going to cut over to our aliens.
We're at a bail bondsman's place for some reason. He's watching It's a Wonderful Life. Remember, it's Christmas.
Yeah, he's got the full goblet of eggnog, right. The most disgusting drink ever.
Was that the first when we had eggnog at the shop?
Yeah, that was the first time.
Griff's first time he had eggnog, he was 25?
There's a lot of firsts for me in my 20s. Yeah. Awful.
You'll never forget.
Did you have eggnog before?
Yeah, I've had eggnog before.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Excuse me.
Well, I thought I was shocked.
You had an alcoholic dad. My dad didn't drink. He was a diabetic.
Well, you can have it without alcohol.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I only drink it. I have like one glass a year. It's one of those things. I'm not like, yeah, let me get some eggnog. Middle of June, and I'm like swigging some eggnog.
You think it's got a nice, smooth taste, though? You're like, what is this?
Do you do
the nutmeg and cinnamon?
No, I don't go that far.
Okay.
But so he hears his dog, of course, hears something. Get the fuck back here, dog. And then we hear that chilling four words.
I bring you peace.
And then Talek grabs the guy, rips his shirt up, and we're like, oh my God, he's going to rape this old man.
Yeah.
These are alien rapists.
I don't know why he had a training undergarment on.
I don't know why old man's wearing a bra, but, you know.
It was the first movie to try to get me used to the idea of a man.
A man's ear?
A man's ear.
A bro or a man's ear?
Thank you.
So, and then he's got like, okay, Talek's got like, they're like,
it's so weird.
They're like,
I'm sorry, it's so weird. That came up earlier in my day. I was talking about bros or man's ears.
I think man's ear sounds better. It sounds more professional.
I think man's ear sounds way better. Yeah. Well, of course, bro nowadays has a negative connotation to it. So
Talek has these like Boba Fett like bracers on.
That's a good call.
And it's a toilet snake is what it is.
It is a toilet snake.
He shoots a toilet snake, like a barb on it, and it goes right into the guy's heart.
And then we get a zoom in of like vials on his wristband, and I had no idea what I was looking at.
You probably thought it was eggnog, but it wasn't. It was heroin.
Okay.
So he's pumping heroin into this guy's heart.
He's getting the heart. Wait, it was pumping.
He's getting a heart out.
Oh, right, because then it addresses. Yeah. Okay, everybody, we've talked about this before. Murray, of course, is Q, and Q is all about adrenochrome, the adrenaline of children. So the aliens have found a way to harvest human beings of adrenochrome, even adults.
Right, it's the most coveted thing in the galaxy.
Right, and it's because they pump the heroin that releases the endorphin that creates the adrenochrome.
Right.
So that's what this science is all about.
Right. We don't know this yet where we're watching this.
We're tipping you off because this movie's shit. Yeah. And you're going to watch it for 20 minutes and be like, Dolph's dick's not out. I don't care.
Right. And so then he pumps him full of that sweet H. And then he's got a RoboCop fucking bracer on the other one. This spike comes out. Chunk right in the guy's fucking forehead, and we see him sucking some juice out of the guy's forehead.
Exactly.
And it goes into that vial system that he has on his arm.
That's the adrenochrome system, which is my favorite solar system. Okay. Anyways, now we're cutting back over to our actual main characters, said with heavy quotes, because these guys fucking suck. They're at the pool hall.
Pool slash titty bar.
Pool bar, titty club. I saw John D. Hart in the background doing a course.
Holden Court.
He was working a couple of new jams out.
Shimmy sliding everywhere.
He didn't want to take it. He didn't want to try out his new.
The chick on the stage was shimmy sliding. She had a little cowgirl outfit on.
She did. Saw some awful tits.
Yeah, some kind of misshapen fake titties.
Like I said earlier,
the technology wasn't worked out as well.
That's what Smith was saying. He's like, the technology's not quite there yet. He's a subscriber to Bolton on Breast Monthly.
As much as we love Boltons, we're here to get Jack's informant boner. Played by the rat guy from Split Second.
Yes.
And he goes up to him, slaps him around a little.
His name happens to be Boner. And if you listen to Dolph closely, you have no idea what his name is. Because Bronner. I was like, it's Bronner?
Bronner.
Bronger?
He's like, hey there, Jack. I don't know anything, man. His buddy, like, his buddy pulls out a switchblade, sniffs there with a gun. He's like, I would put that away if I were you.
Well, it's early 90s, so, of course, gay jokes are right on fucking heat. So, of course, right. He's like, your boyfriend over here thinks you know something.
Jack's got a fucking, his hand cannon against Boner's boner cannon. And he's just like, I don't know anything, guys. We didn't even need this scene. I don't know why this scene's, because Boner has no info.
No, the scene... I hate it. Because I listen. Murray was here when I was fast-forwarding, just kind of get the scenes back in order in my head and everything. And so what this scene was all about, they, of course, leave them. Smith complains, your tactics aren't legal. You can't just pull a hand cannon out on anybody and hold it to their dick. I saw you pull your hand cannon out. Well, he was a man of color, and you never know what they're going to do.
I felt nervous, okay?
I couldn't stop and frisk.
Oh, you're
him
right. Now it's coming back to me.
It is, exactly. Okay, they head back to the crime scene?
Well, no, before that, okay. I'll set up what you thankfully brought back that okay. made the scene make sense.
Okay.
He notices out the corner of his eye, the guy's playing pool, even though he's by a pool table.
He's trapping them on a pool table.
And he goes... Huh, and then he looks right in the camera, puts his finger up to his chin.
There is no subtlety with Dolph Lundgren. That's the other problem I have with him so far. Is he had to pay Brandon Lee to say, tell the audience I have a big dick.
And he's like, I got an idea. And then so they drive back to the other club where the crime scene was.
Uh-huh.
And then he's just like, it's like fucking pool. Ricochets. And he's like, what? He's like, look, hear me out. What, my gut's talking, my instincts are kicking in. See, what if it hit here, and then hit here, and then hit here, and then hit here? He's got the red yarn, he's just making all this shit.
It's beautiful. It is kind of beautiful when they zoom out. It's like Dexter took this scene and made it a whole show.
Right, and then hit here. And they point to this giant fucking stereo speaker.
And it's like humming still. Yeah. There's no audio, but it's humming.
And he's like, those tweeters are off the chain, dude. Pulls off the cover.
Very 90s language. Cowabunga, motherfucker.
I actually got a Ninja Turtle joke I'll tell you about later that Abra came up with.
Okay.
But it pulls off the cover of it, and we see that CD. And he's like, oh, shit, you know, we're fucking... Black Album. I hear this is great.
Oh, God. It was the Black Album?
Yeah.
And no wonder why it was so sharp.
And it was vibrating. And then Smith goes, let me see that. Oh, and he cuts his hand. That's sharp.
Oh, man.
And then he's like, hey, don't touch that. And then he's like, I know what I'm doing. And then he gets both of his forefingers and goes, and then catches it, pulls it out, and then it goes flying everywhere.
Yeah, it just starts flying
around. It's full-on Phantasm here.
Yeah.
So we get the fucking
I like
POV
that
shot.
That Phantasm movie is pretty cool.
Explain it to him because it made no sense to me.
I have no idea, but I remember thinking it was pretty cool.
But we get fucking Phantasm POV. We see from the CD's point of view. It's flying, and then it goes right back to that speaker.
Yeah, and I call it bullshit, but again, they do actually explain this later. Right. Anyways... Now that they have the murder weapon, they're like, let's harness this thing. But we're going to do a nice little quick cut, because anytime our main characters are doing anything transitioning, we have to go back to our aliens.
Right. So now we see Aztec. He's in an alley. He's looking for something, and he notices Metallica.
Yeah, this is when he looks into his giant Apple Watch. That is just blaring into his face, and then he just turns to the sky and is like,
I don't remember that.
Yeah, I just saw this, so that's what.
So he's watching Talik drain the old man?
So what they're trying to suggest is that he's got some kind of tracker on him. So they're saying that Apple Watches are actually a horrible device.
They track you. Yeah.
They track you.
Right.
And so he's using his Apple Watch
that's
to track
why
him.
Get the vaccine, because you're already being tracked, people.
Yeah, really. 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 Oh, my God. Oh,
we're
my God.
Not
going
to
oh
get into
God.
That. We're going to get through
oh
this.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
90-minute movie.
Oh, my God.
So he fucking sees Talik draining the old man's vein, and he just opens. I like the guns.
Old-fashioned or new
I did
fashion.
Not like the way the guns looked. They looked chintzy as fuck, but I liked it. It was like fucking Judge Dredd Lawgivers. They were just spraying fire.
It was great. And, of course, they had to cut these scenes, even though these should have been the main characters, in half. In thirds and fourths and eighths, because all their scenes are just explosions and shit.
Right.
So Aztec opens fire on Talik to get him away from this guy because he's, of course, a drain.
No, wait. You know what? This is Well, we're in a parking garage. This is the black guy that got drained. Okay,
this is the black guy that got.
Yeah,
drained.
I thought we were still. I got confused. I thought we were still at the old man.
No.
Yeah. So we're in a parking garage.
And in fact, I might have to pipe in this audio to give everybody the feel of this scene because this scene was very interesting, very 90s, very 90s rap.
She's an ugly woman, and this is the truth. She got a big rotten tooth and a buckwheat boot. Little kids get ghosts when the girl is near, and she can trick or treat every day of the year. She's a Miss Freaking Free.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Born October 31st and the queen of Halloween. But duck is the term the homeboys use for the whacked out women that we refuse. She's a prehistoric freezer burn, frostbitten.
It's a question. Talik is running for his life, but he decides, I'm going to run on top of cars instead of on the ground. Poor decision by Talik, because he's running across the hoods of cars with those giant Frankenstein boots on, and then he leaps through a window.
We don't know aliens, though.
I don't know
who they hired to method act out their alien, pathing and everything, but I think they did a good job of this. But you're right. The alien gun, very cool. I love the explosions worked because these scenes are very quick and everything, but I would have liked more of the aliens.
Right. So now Jack is getting driven home by Smith. Smith doesn't have a wife or kids, still driving a station wagon for some reason. Just playing what a sub-simp nerd this guy is.
It's Houston.
He chose... for a fucking station wagon, because he's like, hey, it gets great mileage. And so he's dropping Jack. Jack's car was weird, too, because, of course, he had, like, the muscle car that every fucking badass cop has. But did you notice it was, like, a matte paint on it? It was, like, a black matte coating.
I don't know cars well enough. I didn't notice that. Oh, yeah, I guess you don't need to know cars, but still, I didn't notice that.
It just because you used to cars having a glossy kind of. This was matte. It was like, what's he doing?
He's ahead of his time.
Is it covered with primer? What the fuck? But he drops him off at his place. And he's like, I'm taking this evidence because they have the fucking speaker with them.
And Smith, of course, plays it by the book. So he's like, no, I got to take this back to the FBI immediately. We can't do this. Why did I even drop you off here? I got a date with my girlfriend, and I need to get dropped off here, even though she lives across town. And I'm going to beat up these white dudes in the alley. I'm going to go full ball sack on them. No, I'm going to my apartment. I'm going to sleep, and I'm going to take this fucking disc over to the university in the morning.
Yeah, I got a friend at the university. Well, we have like a whole FBI lab. No, I have a friend at the university.
So Smith invites himself in. He pulls a griff.
Right.
I smell booze in your house. I want some of that. So they walk in, and Smith immediately is in awe.
Right. He's like, oh, my God, is that original oil painting of dogs playing poker? He's like, you have class. I was expecting a motorcycle, filth everywhere,
pigeons,
hearts made out of chocolates on your refrigerator. Your place is clean. You have wine in a bottle with a cork, not even a screw-on cap.
Listen to this. Open floor plan as well. That's new.
Feng Shui was off the chain. He had the little hot tub from Little Tokyo in there.
Yeah. He didn't even know how to describe the artwork. Dolph had to explain that to him because he looks at the art and he's like, I never would have thought, because he's expecting a TV.
Right.
Do you notice Dolph did not have a TV?
Right.
He had that artwork.
I just stare at the dogs playing poker. I just see new things every time I look.
Exactly. You notice like a glint in their eye or something. He's like, it's just so...
He's like, I can't believe... I'm the guy who's all about books, and I just judged a book by its cover.
Oh, Marie. Yeah, little character development happening here? No, not at all.
And then Jack offers him wine. He's like, this is actually from a wine cellar. This isn't from like fucking the corner store here. This is some great shit. There's a cork in this fucking thing.
Yeah, and Smith
swigs it.
He's so disgusted. He doesn't smell. He doesn't taste. He swigs it.
He's like, I noticed some subtle peach flavor in there. Yeah, I know. It's my favorite kind.
So Smith fucks right off. He's just like, I gotta go. Station wagon waits.
Yeah, station wagon's running outside.
And so Dolph, left to his own devices, he takes the bottle of wine and he fucking sits down at his couch where he has one picture of him and Diane facing the camera that he grabs and turns to himself. And he's just like, Diane!
No, he's like, I gotta get my dick wet. So he does the old booty call, but he's nice enough to go to her place for the booty call. He doesn't call her over, so he is a gentleman.
Yeah.
But he's like, I know she hates me, but I got to get my dick wet. So he rushes over.
Hey, this is a very ballsack scene.
Yeah. rushes over to Diane's. He did ask, where was my walleye on the wall? And she's like, you never lived here to begin with.
What my mounted fuck? Walleye.
So he just comes in. She slaps him. You have a lot of nerve coming here. It's like 3 in the morning and shit. But I still want to fuck you, goddammit. And then it is fucking.
She says, I want an apology now. And he undoes her top. And he touches her nipple.
So can you at least remember my birthday? I'll think about it.
He touches the other nipple. Fuck, I hate how I want your dick.
And then he honks her tits, and then we just fade out. Nice, like, erotic kind of scene.
Yeah. Well, there was the rain stick where they turned it over, and then they faded away. That's beautiful.
Jake,
I mean, it's good shit.
Just tell me my birthday. Not even, like, tell me you love me. Tell me my birthday.
Just please remember anything about me.
Jack, he, like, sneaks out in the morning. Doesn't want it. He's like, ugh, you know.
Yeah.
Gets back, gets in his car with the matte painting on it. Gets home, finds out his door is open. And he's like, I always close my door when I leave. That's strange.
Yeah.
Sees the place. Now it looks like a real cop's place. Shit everywhere. Motorcycle there. He didn't
have this looked like Phil Marlowe's place from The Long Goodbye.
And he's like, uh-oh.
So he's skulking around. He's thinking that the perp is still in his house and everything. Right. And this is where Smith pops out. Hey, I just welcomed myself in here. I wanted a little bit more of that wine. I don't know why I didn't hear this voice.
I don't know why. Nothing close to what they guys said.
Nothing close. But he of course, they're cops, so they're pulling guns on each other. Right. And, you know, there's a little bit of a jump scare.
So we're also getting a little bit. Can we trust Smith? You know, that's because we don't know where he's coming from. We know that he goes by the book, which already tells you you can't trust this guy.
Smith told us he came back here to get the disc. Right. So he was here to just take the disc, but the disc wasn't there.
No, he said he was there to pick up Jack. They were because he was going to go with him to the university.
Oh, okay, okay. Because the disc was still there. They did take it together. You're right. But before we go back to the university, Murray, go to the university, transition scene, so we need to see our aliens.
Right. Exactly. So we see a woman working on a car. I'm already confused.
It's an 80s hair metal video, right?
Yeah. I'm like, woman? They don't know anything about cars. What is going on here?
Teased up hair that's pulled back. She's got like, she's got the what do they call that? The jumper or something?
Jumpsuit, yeah.
She's got the jumpsuit on, but for whatever reason, you know, she's got it zipped down just enough so you can see the cleave, and she's just wearing the brassiere underneath it. Brassiere, not a man. Yeah. Zier.
She is a woman.
Yep. She is a woman, after all. So she's working on the car. She's just, like, grinding out on things. Not just the hood. She's not a mechaphile. She actually is ratcheting something.
Right. She's just making it look like she knows what she's doing.
Yep.
But remember, she's a woman. And then you hear that fucking call again.
I bring you peace.
And you know what that means. She's going to get milked. And sure enough, he rips open this is an R-rated movie, so I'm like, all right, we see some tits at least.
Yeah.
No, he's like, I don't want to see your tits.
Yeah, we're all
I respect you.
We're already done with tits, by the
way. Yeah, yes. Yeah. No more tits for this movie.
Yeah.
He's like, I'm just going to pump you full of H and suck out your adrenochromes.
I couldn't figure out the white coming in or the white coming out.
It was kind of like a golden brown when it came out.
Oh, it was a golden brown?
It was almost like a nice beer.
Okay.
And he milks her, and then he's done. Back to Jack.
You get the knife to the head, and then we're done, yeah.
We go to this university. I don't know what university. This is probably the university the nerds at Revenge of the Nerds went to. Because we have this insane guy working there.
Yeah, you know what? He was a little too quirky. He definitely was a nerd.
Yeah.
And he definitely was into raping.
Yeah. And he's just screaming. He's like, hold on a second, Jack. And just screams.
Well, didn't you recognize the scene? We talked about it earlier. Well, not the scene specifically, but Breaking Bad. Turned a whole episode out of the scene.
Yeah, because he is making lab coffee, which I think we've seen in a couple movies.
Probably. Yeah, probably.
Because we see all the apparatus that we see in every mad scientist thing.
Yeah.
But he's like, he's brewing tea. Brewing coffee.
They're slowly building up to it, so we're watching the Rube Goldberg system of chemistry happening here, and then he sips on it, and he's freaking the fuck out.
Yeah.
Then he's got a table full of pills that he's just taking, apparently.
Yeah, because he's like, with Jack's like, well, this guy's a fed. What the fuck? Because he's got fucking coke, fucking pills, everything. He throws it into a drawer.
Oh, my God.
He's like, why didn't you tell me, Jack? He's like, no, he's okay. He's cool. Don't worry about it.
He's pretty cool. And, of course, he put his Quiznos away because he's like, I don't want the squares knowing about Quiznos.
Right.
Quiznos is
He's
for
making his own mayo also in a lab thing.
Shh.
Just dripping out
I wasn't going to bring that up. Anyways, so of course they're like, "What is it about the dance? What is going on?" And of course Smith notices it, and it's like they've made like their own monument to it. He's just fashioned this overnight, like this super secret chamber for it.
Electromagnetic chamber.
And
whatever.
So the disc is just sitting in there hovering, spinning at some crazy RPM.
But it's playing some great fucking Metallica.
Yeah. Oh, shit. He's going to Black Album.
Yeah, this is. I told you this album.
You said good.
No, I told you this is the Black Album. This CD is the Black Album.
I know you did, but you said good Metallica.
Well, I'm just saying. Well, for what they were for them. Mm. So he's like, "Look, you fucking idiots! This is a magnetic. All it's not only is it the greatest Metallica album ever, it's also a killer magnet."
Yeah. What he ends up explaining, Murray's having a little bit of trouble with this. So we know the ICP song where they say magnets. How the fuck do those work?
We learn.
This is the scene. So we're not going to tell you because me and Murray, we're not scientists.
So please direct this episode and Dark Angel to the fat guy from ICP because he will learn what a magnet.
Yeah, there's Shaggy 2 Dope and Violent J.
Yeah, fat guy.
Yeah, Shaggy 2 Dope is the fat guy.
I think it's the opposite.
You think it's the opposite?
Yeah.
I've been to his house, so I should know.
And you told me it was a tastefully done house.
It was incredibly tasteful.
You had a Jack and Smith moment. You were expecting Halloween USA just vomited in his house.
Exactly.
And it was like, wow.
It was a beautiful family house. It was ridiculous. And like the guy told me, because it was a total juggalo. Juggalo?
Juggalo?
It was a total juggalo, but the guy was so fucking... Look, I don't give a shit how ridiculous you look. As long as you're kind to other human beings, guess what? I fucking like you.
Wow. That human lesson we've learned from Griff. So he goes, "Look, idiots."
Did you bleed on my notes, by the way? There's like a blood spot on here.
What?
Yeah, there's like a little red. Is that blood?
Let me see. My God. First of all, it's like a dot. He's making it look like I had a nosebleed all over. I have no idea what that is. Probably from you.
All right. So Brucey, he's like, this disc, it's all the magnets in the world. But it can tune ourselves because we're electricity. Very David Lynch line right there. Yeah. It's like, so this disc could be tuned in to any electrical current. It's a homing device. Like, he could shoot this, track it to your magnetic field, and make it kill you. So, like, oh, this is very powerful. All right, so we're going to take it for the feds. No, you're not.
I need to do more tests on it.
And Smith is okay with it.
Yeah. So, well, he learned that Jack has class. He's been to Jack's apartment, so now they're thawing. The ice is thawing.
I like how you said that. Yeah, the ice is thawing.
So they go back to Diane because there's more bodies popping up with these strange fucking bullet holes, quotation mark, in their head and in their chest. So they're like, Diane's a coroner for the city. So like, what's going on with these bodies? And she's like, get this shit. This isn't a bullet hole. This is a puncture wound in their head.
Yeah.
And he's like, what?
This could have been Shugar from No Country for Old Men.
And they're all... Every one of these bodies, they're connected. This is the same MO.
Excuse me, how can you explain that? Because the other ones had, like, CD slashes across their necks. These guys just have weird punctures. Look, Diane's my squeeze. I know we're on the rocks right now, but she knows what she's talking about.
So, like, all right, thanks, Diane. Let us know if you come up with any information after that. So they walk out, and some guy's like, hey, FedEx just sent this to you.
They're at a hospital. They're not at police headquarters. They're not anywhere Jack would be. But somebody just happens to have a delivery for him.
Are you sure they're out? I thought they were just at the fucking police station.
I thought so too, but then I came back to it, and I was like, this is just like a completely separate place.
Okay.
So it's very strange that this scene happens.
It's like, Jack, I got a... Somebody FedEx do something here. They opens it up. We lied because we see some titties here. Opens it up. Mm. There's a picture of our man Victor,
and some side ass.
Victor Manning.
Some long back, excuse me.
That's sad because he's in Brazil, and Brazilian girls are known for having big asses, so there must have been some booty shortage going on in the 1990s.
Maybe he was trying to fucking trick Dolph.
Oh. Anyway, it's our man Victor Manning, who we never see again for the rest of the movie.
Yeah, we really don't. Like, I don't... never mind. I'm sorry.
And he's with two Brazilian babes, topless, and he's got, hey, wish you were here in Rio!
Fucking Dennis Miller showing up again, babe.
And he's just like, damn you, Manning. He says DaCosta. He hates this guy.
Yeah, and of course he leaves a note like, hey, I can't drop in and fuck with you, but my man Warren's going to pay you a visit soon. And that sets Jack Kane off. He's like, motherfucker, I'm about to raise some Kane right now. And in some parts of the world, that means
that
chicken strips.
That would have been a better title, Raising Kane.
But that's a chicken strip place.
I'm just saying, Dark Angel sucks.
Dark Angel does suck. It's awful.
So he's like, I think we got to lead Warren. Because they don't know what the fuck they're... Because his instincts are going nowhere. He's just basically stumbling in the dark.
Yes, but you're right that Smith is starting to buy into it. So he's like, oh, you got another instinct? Let's follow it. So they hop in his station wagon. And he's like, where are we going to go? Where are we going to go? He's like, I think you should let me drive. Because Dolph is in the passenger seat. And he's like, no. Nobody drives Bessie but me. I got the handle. I got the turn signal. And then all of a sudden...
We see some white boys in the rear view.
Because they drive a red Countach.
Right. Because they're yuppie scum. This is exactly. The 80s. We hate fucking yuppies.
They've got the psycho, the Batman guy, Christian Bale. They've got slicked back hair. They're coke fiends.
Patrick Bateman?
Bateman. Wait, what?
Patrick Bateman.
Oh, that's the character from
American Psycho?
Yeah. I've never watched that movie.
It's overrated.
It's over. Okay.
And and they're like, you know, they look like Don Jr. basically.
They do. Oh my god.
And they got machine guns. So they start opening fire on our boys. So
does that make Wilson their dad or whatever his name is? Warren?
Warren, yeah.
And so they're trying to please him?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
And they open fire. We get a boring, like, chase. But we do see Sam pulls out the Terminator gun with the laser scope out for no reason.
That gun was stupid, and it was awesome. And you're expecting something awesome. And I like how they did this, because you're like, oh, Sam. Wait, Sam?
Smith.
His name is Sam Smith?
No. His name is Arwood Smith. We learned at the very end his name is Arwood. But people call me Larry.
What? You know what I mean? That was awful.
Yeah.
So Smith jumps in the backseat. He's like, what should I do? What should I do? You should shoot at him, Smith. And so he uses that giant-ass fucking hand cannon and shoots at him.
It's the Terminator gun. Yeah.
It is. You know what? I forgot about that. Yeah, it was very cool.
And then they stop at Warren's. It's like the – because remember, they're drug dealers, but their front is their respectable businessmen. They're like DaCosta.
Yeah.
And so they pull up. Jack's like, I got a plan to get in because there's no way I can get past those two guards.
Smith reminds him, this is against protocol.
Yeah, he's like, we have no search warrants. I don't need, my gut tells me I don't need a search warrant.
He grabbed his dick and said, this is my search warrant right here.
Search this motherfucker.
Yeah, exactly.
And then he starts, because, and I like, you notice how, like, and this was earlier too when he comes home. There's always a parking spot in front of his fucking apartment building. There's a parking spot right in front of this high rise.
And Warren has 15 sports cars in front of his place. And so
all the white boys' cars.
Yeah, he sets off all the alarms on it, which draws a bunch of guards out because they're like, oh my God, is someone fucking with Mr. Warren's cars? So he gets in there with a little bit of resistance, but it's just like two guards at this point. So he roundhouses both of them, hops in the elevator, farts all over it because Dolph can't go anywhere without leaving a stench. Gets up to the executive floor where, of course, Warren's holding court.
They're having a meeting because they're businessmen.
He pops in with his gun just blazing. He's always got to have that gun out, ball sack style.
Right. Just swinging his dick around, pissing on plants, marking his territory.
He might as well have been walking in there with a Bud Light with a fucking Coca-Cola fucking label just printed over it.
No, he had Pepsi. This was a Pepsi movie.
Oh, he's a Pepsi.
Because there was, and when the scene where the mechanic, she had a Pepsi cup
right next to the album she was listening to, because she had the full fucking LP right there in her toolkit. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Notice that. Okay.
And so Warren's like, what the fuck's going on here? You're busted assholes. He has no evidence. He's nothing.
Nothing.
He's
he has nothing. Just the picture that says Warren's coming for you.
But he's so confident that it kind of shakes Warren. And he's like, oh, really? Are you the one in charge or am I? And then when he says that, some white boys come in with Smith. It's three white boys. Smith being one of them. And he's like, what are you going to do now, motherfucker? We're going to kill your fucking partner.
This is where we don't get Smith making a joke about his partner's dying. Warren hits him with, oh, did you need another partner? Because I know you go through them like applesauce in a fucking old folks home.
That's a great metaphor.
Thank you. That was off the cuff, everybody.
So here's what you're going to do for us. You're going to make a drug drop-off for us. Or we're going to kill your partner. And then the fucking Dolph just looks at the camera, crosses his hands. Hands tied.
Hands
can't
tied.
Do anything.
Hands tied. Oh,
so this is where it gets good. This is where the movie finally gets
Excuse
good.
Excuse me?
For 5 seconds, it gets good.
Oh, okay.
Because we got to make the drop off. So he shows up at, it was like a suitcase, luggage place. It sells luggage? What the fuck was this place?
They show up at like a hotel or something. But yeah, you're right. It was just like this beautiful hotel first floor. But instead of having like a bar, like a piano or some classy shit, it was just suitcases. And we walk up and we see the back of like the, you know, the front desk guy. And you're immediately, when you've got a trained eye like we do, you're like, excuse me.
I know that
skulllet, receding hairline, long, flowing over the shoulders, turned profile, Fu Manchu. Oh my God, Al fucking Leong.
Yes, Al Leong again.
Oh my God.
Seems like it's only been 2 weeks since we talked about Al Leong.
I know, and this was a shock to both of us.
And he was out of character because he was total geek. He had like a checkered button-down up shirt with a tie on.
Not good at all. But you know what, everybody? And we might skip ahead a little bit to do this, but Murray, I'm going to go ahead and squeeze this in because Al Leong had fucking lines.
Let's hear him.
Yes, sir. What can I do for you? Don't be foolish. Tell the white boys to kiss my ass.
And it's just important to get any Al Leong line out
right,
there.
Right, you never hear him.
Because you never get to hear him. So,
and he is the voice of a dark angel.
He is the dark angel of this movie.
Right.
That's what they were alluding to.
So they both have Kinch attaché cases. Dolph's got the heroin in his. Al's supposed to have the money, but Dolph opens it and it's empty.
Oh, okay. And he pulls a gun out and he says... Tell the white boys to kiss my ass. You know this. You heard this. But tell the white boys to kiss my ass.
And then he just fucking goes out the back door into an alley.
So Dolph very slowly just kind of lumbers after him. And he comes to a point where it's like, you know, the wall, you can't see, like the wall darts out to the right. And Al Leong just collapses
right
in front of him.
You're thinking Al Leong's going to get the drop on him because he's hiding behind. And then he just falls face first.
And Dolph watches it. And he's just like, whatever, I was going to do that anyways. But that's when Talik appears.
Right. And he's just about to, I think, kill Dolph. And while that's going on, because for some reason they brought Smith with them, the white boy. So they're in a car with Smith.
Right. So they were parked out front. They hear all the gunfire. Smith fights back, makes his own escape. No fight off. He just makes his own escape, and he's trying to find Dolph for the hot tag.
Right. And so Aztec shows up just as Talik's about to take on Dolph. And then all hell breaks loose. He starts shooting the lawgivers at each other. Fire's flying everywhere.
Right. Important thing to take away from this awful scene, it's just a mess, there's explosion, because they're guns, they're super cool, they look bad, but, yeah, crazy.
We have
crazy.
No idea what, are there projectiles? It looks like this fire comes out of the gun.
It's just an explosion, it's a Michael Bay explosion gun. Yeah. That's all it is. Or you could go with the John Woo, but at least he slows it down a little bit.
There were no doves in this alley.
Yeah.
And so they just chase each other off, Talik and Aztec. And they're like, what the fuck is happening here?
But we know that Talik got away with the briefcase.
He did.
Okay? So that's the important thing to remember.
Right. Did we even point out that, yes, Talik stole the heroin from the first one, too? Because that's how he's using... he doesn't have his own heroin, people. He has to, you know... And he ain't going to pay for it.
You think that aliens would have figured out opium at this point?
No.
Or
so, yeah,
fentanyl.
He's all about stealing drugs. Somehow he's got, like, a fucking police scanner radar. Somehow he knows where drugs are going to be.
Apple Watches do that.
Okay. Back at the HQ, Smith is, like, complaining about the fucking disc some more. Like, because I think they went back. They didn't go back, did they, yet?
This is the hospital, okay. I think. I got it confused, but whatever. They go back. They're talking more with Diane. And, of course, they're trying to figure out why, like, the aliens are doing what they're doing. Of course, I believe at this point, Dolph is starting to formulate, a whole thing about aliens, and Diane's kind of feeding into
it. She got the toxicology reports back, and she's like, I ain't gonna believe this. They were, that hole in the heart, that was pure heroin injected in their hearts. And then they took, because they, you know about what heroin does. It fucking makes it doubles your endocrines, or what are they called?
Adrenochrome.
Adrenochrome.
Which is crazy. Again, I'll remind everybody, because children get adrenaline rush, the adrenochrome. So adults aren't supposed to get it, but when you feed them with heroin.
Right.
You should know this, Q.
Well, there's even some things Q doesn't know. Even Q's got to do his research.
Oh, okay.
She's like, we all know heroin's the best high ever. We've all done heroin, right? Right, 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 right. And then he's like, well, explain some more. And she's like, adrenochromes. That's it. And then so Dolph's like, okay, he has an aha moment. He's like putting it all together.
They've got to be aliens because no one else would
harvest. Even though they look human, totally human. They have fucked up haircuts. They got milky eyes. I don't know if they've got cataracts, but they're still looking human. But he immediately goes alien.
Yeah.
Because he's like, oh, I've never seen the CD technology before, and I've seen everything. I mean, like other countries could have actually developed this. We don't know, but he knows. Why? Instincts.
But we do get a quick cut over after we hear all about the endorphins and the heroin. We see Talek. He's at the park or some watery background.
He's by some waterways.
And he's prepping up like the little heroin vials or something. He's got the briefcase open.
He's just admiring them. He's like, yeah. he's got like this little like coolant chamber on his fucking
He's got
thing.
A Batman tool belt on his wrist.
Right. Yeah, I look kind of Predator to me.
Oh, Predator. Okay.
And he's an alien, remember? Yes. Maybe they have the same technologies. Maybe they have like a trade thing going on.
Maybe
predators love this fucking adrenochrome. That's how they get high before they go hunting.
That might be it.
So he's like, I'm gonna fucking sell. I'm gonna make so much money off these predators. And he's looking at that heroin. He's like, puts the bag up, smells the bag.
That's like, Back to the Future 2, where he finds the fucking sports almanac with all the things to bet on. That's it. He got the heroin. He's gonna go back to his own place. He's gonna be a quadrillionaire. So many warlocks.
So now, because of course, this scene needs to be here because we learned from Diane what he's doing. So now they have to show us.
They had to affirm to the audience that Diane and Jack's suspicion that alien technology might be involved here. Right. So Jack leaves. Smith has been hanging out by the payphone.
Right. And he's like, "What the fuck's going on? You're not aliens. It's aliens, man. Lizard people." And he's like, what the fuck are you talking about? I knew you wouldn't believe me. It's aliens.
So well, can we go back to Bruce and get that disc? I really want to get it checked out.
Yeah, I want some real professionals to check it out, not your crackhead friend. So they go back. Bruce has got a big-ass shiner. He's got the stake on his eye. They're like, what the fuck happened, Bruce?
Fucking gumshoes who look like your flat-top, square-headed buddy over
meanwhile,
here.
Meanwhile, no payoff for this scene. We never learn what happened.
No, there is.
There is?
There 100% is.
Oh, I don't remember it.
Yeah, I know you don't, because I can see it in your eye. I read eyes.
Your instincts are good.
Thank you. Because he says, yeah, your friend over here, they look just like him. Square head, flat top, no personality.
Two eyes, nose, mouth.
Mm-hmm. White.
He didn't need to go there.
Cracker.
So Bruce fucking got robbed. Got to go to... Who's Malone?
Malone?
We go to Malone.
Captain.
Oh, Captain Malone?
Okay. Yeah.
What does he do, Griff?
Well, no. Before we go see Malone. Malone is Jack's captain. So they need to report to him. For whatever reason, despite it being about aliens, Jack's like, I'm going to tell Captain Malone all about the aliens.
Yeah, he'll believe me.
He's going to get 18 weeks vacation.
He hates my guts, but he'll believe this story.
But because we're going into transition, Murray, we got to do another quick cut.
It's been 5 minutes and we've seen an alien. Cut to a party store. We got guys hanging out, as like losers do. They hang out at the party store, bother the guy working there.
Hey, one of those was a cop.
Well, he was a security guard. I don't know. He was Barney Fife. And he's looking at a Flex magazine, like ogling these guys, oiled up guys. And they're just shooting the shit. And then Talek shows up.
Of course he does.
He'll take the endochrome. I guess you want drug addict endochromes because they really got the shit in them. Because this guy looks like a crackhead who's like hanging out with the guy working there.
Yeah.
And they're like, hey, man, what the fuck's going on with you? And then he's like, he says it again.
Well, one of the guys even said, like, there's this crazy dude with pure white hair and fucking white eyes coming around just fucking murdering people. And then Talek shows up. He's like, pisses himself a little bit, drops his men's magazine.
Yeah, because I think Talik kills the crackhead and the guy working at the thing with the CD gun, right?
Right.
And then he's like, "Oh, I'm gonna juice this flex."
He thinks he's gonna
man.
Juice him, yeah.
So he's getting ready to do that, but no, Aztec's got the Apple Watch going.
Oh yeah, so he shows up. He starts firing the fucking automatic pistol, weird fucking gun he has.
Lawgiver.
The lawgiver, the Michael Bay lawgiver.
He says incendiary rounds.
Yeah.
And then he just starts blowing up this fucking party store.
And so we're thinking in this small enclosure that Aztec's finally going to get an edge on Talik. But no, somehow the tables get turned and Aztec suffers an injury here.
Yeah, he gets shot somehow. I don't remember how.
I don't remember how either.
But he's fucked up. Talik takes off, fucks off again, runs with it. He's just this constant scenes of Talik running with a fucking fireball behind him.
Exactly. It's awful.
So he gets away.
So transition over. We're back over to Jack. He's back at headquarters. He's telling Malone, aliens! Look, brother, I know this is going to sound crazy. Aliens. Endorphins. Adrenochrome.
Endorphins rise to the top, brother. And he's like, what the fuck are you talking? Dustin is about to lay into Jack to get a call about that party store explosion.
Yeah.
Like, we got to check this out. So they go over there. Because it fits the MO of all these giant explosions happening around Houston.
Yeah. But by the time we get there, fucking EMTs, the fire squad. That's what
fire
we call
fire department.
It. Fire department's there. The FBI are there. The fucking police are already there. And somehow Malone's already there, too.
Right.
Even though Malone was just there and they were just leaving, Malone's there. But this
I think because Jack and Smith stopped off for a quiz.
That's...
You know, and it takes a while, but...
When you need to do your best detecting...
If you want quality food, you got to wait for it.
Yeah, exactly. And when you need to detect things, you need that quiz.
Right.
Yeah.
And he demanded that they restock the pepper bars. Like, these will not do. So, he was even an hour late, so they show up.
These will not do.
They show up, and Jack's, like, about to go under the tape. Like, you cannot... do not cross this tape.
I'm Jack Kane. Are you pulling rank with Jack fucking Kane?
You're on vacation, Jack. Fuck off.
Excuse me.
And then Sam's like, don't. Sam. Now I'm saying Sam. It's Smith.
Smith.
Smith is like, don't worry. I'm a Fed. There's Switzer right there.
Swizzler's over there.
Check it out. And he's like, and then they're like, no, you can't go through either. And Swizzler's like, come on. Come here, boy. And then they're like, nothing happened here. Nothing happened here.
Yeah. Malone walks over. Like I said, Malone's somehow already here. He walks over to Jack. He's like, you know what, Jack? I need you to fuck off. You know that vacation I've been telling you about? You're on it. You're on it, Buster. So get him on nose cutter.
So Diane shows up. She is the coroner. She's got to examine these bodies. And they're like, no, even you can't go through here. So she sees Jack. She's like, Jack, what the fuck's going on? He's like, you know what? Why don't you quit your job and come with me?
Yeah. Go home.
Give up your life for me because I'm going to be on vacation. I need somebody to fuck for the next 8 weeks.
He simply said, my dick feels a little dry. I want your moist-ass mouth all over my cockles.
Wow. See, he knows how to. He knows a good blowjob when he sees it. You don't like the cat bath blowjob, but they grift us. And she's like, when? You know, like, right now? I'll quit my job right now. She's such a doormat. Everyone's such a sub to fucking Jack.
It is. It's depressing.
And she's like, I'll go back and get my sexy lingerie. And she just fucks off.
Yeah.
Smith comes up. He's like, what the fuck's going on? You know, we need to... He's like...
Smith simply comes up, and he's just like, look, Jack, what you need to understand is that the FBI is doing a really good job here. They figured it all out. All we need to do is sit back and help them out. And Jack's like, my instinct tells me, right. Fuck them and fuck you. Right. Are you telling me you're with them?
Right. He's like, you see these here? These are ostrich skin boots. Only guys who follow their own rules wear ostrich skin boots, all right? I'm a maverick.
And I'm a guy who dots the I's and crosses the T's. I'm higher than you. I make 3 times as much as you. My hairline's better than you. And you know what?
It wasn't really.
No, it wasn't. No. You may have 5 feet on me, but I can get it wet.
You can keep it wet. And that just... stuns Jack. So Jack just walks off. He's like, fine. He gets in his car to leave. He says, strike three. We forgot when strike two happened. Maybe he just went straight to strike. Maybe he doesn't even know what baseball is. He's just making up the rules.
Because
he plays by his own rules. He's like, that's strike three. What about strike two? There is no strike two in my big game of baseball.
Yeah.
Gets in his car.
Maybe it was a foul ball, so he just knew.
And he's just sitting there. And then we see in the back seat, Aztec's there, and he's bleeding all over the place. You know, it's, you know, he's bleeding the stuff. Have you ever seen the movie The Stuff?
I think maybe Mike made me watch
it. It was just a substance people found in the earth. They said, they tasted it. This tastes good. And they started selling it. And it turned out it was this creature that like attacks your body. This guy's bleeding the stuff.
Question. NPR did a thing about movies that were futuristic that took place in 2022. Soylent Green.
Yeah.
Is that a good movie?
It's okay. I mean, we probably should do it this year because it's just 2022.
Oh, you think it'd be fun to do?
Maybe, yeah. I mean,
I'm just curious because it's like one of those movies you hear name dropped all the time.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe we'll do it. So he's bleeding the stuff all over fucking. He's like, careful, that's fucking suede because he loves his suede. We see he's got the suede jacket on. Mm. He's like. And then while he's about to bitch out Aztec for messing up his car, Smith comes. I keep wanting to say Sam now because of your fucking ass. Smith comes
in. What did I do?
You called him Sam, and I stuck with me.
I don't even remember calling him Sam. Yeah. Anyways.
So he's like, and another thing, mister. And then he's like, hey, buddy. And he's like, what the fuck?
This guy in the back of your car. And he's pulling out his gun. He's like, no, this is the cool alien I told you about. He's bringing love.
I mean, his hairline's worse than both of ours.
Yeah, exactly. He's kind of hot.
And then we see Aztec. He's like, I'm an officer. What you call endorphins, we call adrenochrome. It's the most priceless spice melange in the universe. You have to stop Talek. If people find out how sweet your adrenochromes are, your planet will be destroyed by every intergalactic drug fiend in the world. Please promise me you'll stop him. And then Smith's like, hey, we got proof at least. Look at this cool gun. And he's like, we got the body. They'll believe us. And then when he just says that,
He went fucking low pan. He starts shooting out white lights from his eyes and his mouth.
He low panned.
Wait, is low pan an alien?
He was a ghost, maybe.
One man's Chinese god is another man's alien.
Right.
Oh.
And then he just kind of popcorn fart explodes.
Yeah, it was really sad, yeah. You know, you definitely don't want to drive in that car anymore. The farts are just fucking embedded in those seats forever.
Well, suede's ruined with all that stuff on it.
Suede on the inside.
And so they're like, fuck, what are we going to do? We don't have any fucking proof. Well, I got this giant gun. Now, Smith's got this gun. He's like, I can't wait to kill somebody with this fucking gun.
Well, yeah, he's a cop after all. FBIs are still cops, everybody. Right. Yeah.
And so we got this. I'm going to go to Switzerland with it. No, let's keep it. I'm going to do my job. All right, Jack?
He already gave him a strike three.
Right.
So now what he's doing is Jack is ejecting him from his life. Walk, mister. He didn't even do it with a John DeHart walk. No. He just said walk,
like,
mister.
You disgust. My instincts tell me you're a bitch.
Yeah.
And then he runs back. Switzer, look what
he
I got.
He runs like Steven Seagal over to him with like wrist limp, flipping hands like he's treading water or something. It's awful. And Switzer's just there with a little grocery bag.
Well, no, there is. We got to point out there was a scene. We don't have to, but I'm going to point it out.
Okay.
There was a scene. He's like, yeah, you're going to go to your boss, and he's going to give the old story about breaking a few eggs.
Murray.
To make an omelet.
Look, as they said in the Hive song, you can't make an omelet without breaking a couple of eggs.
And
song.
So, you know, cause that's the little back to the shadow for shadow.
Back to for shadow. We haven't done this in a while. Back to for shadow.
So then we have a little clandestine meeting between Swizzler and Smith.
Clandestine, isn't that a horse word?
No, it's a. I'm using the proper word.
What's the horse?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Are there a breed of horses called
Clydesdales?
Like, Clydesdale.
Yeah, my grandpa loved Clydesdales. He had a lot of like little statues of
Clydesdales. That's the weirdest thing.
Yeah.
What is the thing that's your equivalent of Clydesdales?
What do you mean?
Do you have something
like an animal?
No. Like just
Shouldn't
like some, something you collect that someone would walk in and be like, "Why do you collect that?" Because that is a weird.
I'm sure I do, but I can't think of it right now.
Okay.
So I don't want
to. I already know.
I want to get through this episode.
I already know mine's the Graham brothers on the wall.
Okay.
Like anybody who walks, or Bart Oates as well.
because they're just like, why do you have so many sexy? You're straight, aren't you? Why do you have so many sexy men?
The first question people ask me when they walk in my house. Are you straight? There's a lot of sexy gentlemen.
Well, what did your lady friend say? Because she's got the fucking Apple Watch Gaydar.
She's got the Apple Watch Gaydar, and yeah. She's like, you're stupid.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so they're having a clandestine meeting. They're at like a fountain. They're like in Vegas now. There's a fountain going.
There's always a fountain. When anything hot is going down, there's got to be water involved. We know this. Anything fucking shady.
I forgot. We forgot. We
talked about it slightly. We did a good job of
But before Aztec died, he said, if you want to find Talik, you have to go where there's a waterway. He literally said that. So even aliens do dirty shit on the docks.
If you want to find Talik, think of Golan Globus. Think of where villains hide. Think of the waterway.
So even alien, and that's the one universal that touches all life forms. We all do our dirty work at the docks.
Why are we doing Golan Globus Theater? Because we know it gets out to the aliens.
Right. Yeah. It does, because it just goes out there.
We're trying to
send... got a giant fucking,
Satellite
that shoots it. Is it a satellite? I thought, what's the thing they called it that's on the ground that shoots out the...
Oh, I think satellites. Well, satellite, okay. Yeah, it's supposed
it's like
to be
a disc.
In the atmosphere.
I don't know. Satellite, satellite dish. That's what it is, Tim. God damn it. Giant satellite dish that's shooting out the sweet goodness of Golan Globus Theater.
Ooh, yeah. Well, because we know if the aliens are intercepting Twitter, they're like, these fucking humans need to die. But if they intercept Golan Globus Theater, where we welcome everybody.
Right, we're guaranteeing that we will never be served how to serve men. It'll be literally they want to serve us. It won't be like eating us, like
we
Twilight
just,
Zone.
We just need to kind of balance Jack Baudelaire.
Baudelaire.
And his men novelists with the women novelists. And we're all set. We've got every base covered.
Yes.
I think.
So... We learned instincts are king because as Switzer's like, you did a good job, boy. We're gonna reverse engineer this shit.
Pats him on the head, gives him a little pat on the bottom, says, yeah, we're into that around here at the FBI.
And then he's like, oh, thank you, sir. Hey, what's that over there? And
sits him down.
Yeah, and then Smith looks away. What, boss, what?
Did you see a quarter in that file? I think I see a Sacagawea quarter over
Make
there.
Make a wish, buddy.
Yeah.
And then as he's doing, he's like, oh, really? I love Sacagawea. Pulls out the gun, puts it up to Smith's head, and then bam! It's our boy Jack. He followed him. He's like, my instincts told me.
You get a nice Western whistle. Woo-hoo! And it's fucking Jack.
And he has the great, like, never trust nobody. Cain Manual, page 1, chapter 1.
Okay, who starts chapter 2 on page 1? Fuck you. You're dumb as shit. This line is awful, but whatever.
It motivates Smith. Smith grabs his badge and just throws it in the fountain with dead Swizzler. And they're like, we need to kick some ass. So they head to where's the nearest waterway?
Where is the
that
nearest
way? They're in Houston, so they're near water.
Well, are they using Jack's instinct again? Does he just like lick his finger like a golfer and hold it to the wind? And he's like,
he goes
that way.
Salt, it's ocean
salt,
water.
Salt, it's Houston, motherfucker.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure Houston's kind of far from salt water.
Isn't the Gulf of Mexico salt water?
Oh yeah, I guess it. That is like southeast of Houston, right?
Yeah, I thought Houston was near on the Gulf. That's why they always get hit by those fucking hurricanes.
Yeah, okay. I'm thinking of something more inland. Yeah, Houston is kind of close to the ocean. But anyways.
So they head out to the abandoned building by the wharfs.
Of course. And immediately they're walking through. There's a couple jump scares. There's an abandoned building. You see the water. You hear the fucking waves. And they're just like, is that a suitcase over there?
There's hobo fires everywhere.
Oh, well, yeah.
Then you see one drum that's got the Kenji Tashie case with all the bags open.
I can't even imagine the creatures that are lurking around because we know in California the Zerthers leak. They're just lurking everywhere. We don't know what's going on in Houston. We haven't talked to Lycanthropus Chris in a while.
Chris lives in Texas. He would know about all the creatures there.
So we'll have to ask him again, like, what's going on in Houston? Because there's definitely some mythological beasts happening here. Right. There's some cryptozoology happening here. But then they spot the suitcase, and very much Dumb and Dumber, they just kind of like, oh, that's the suitcase.
They're about to grab it, and then Talik shows up.
Starts, it just pops out.
Starts Michael Bay in it. They
might as well have been a lights out moment, lights on moment.
Dolph's like, I got this. And he just starts roundhousing Talik, and Talik no-sells every single kick. And then they start, like, shooting at Talik, no-sells it. Why was Talik running from Aztec? Because he gets shot by the gun.
Aztec's gone.
And does nothing to him. He just runs through it. So I don't know why he was running from fucking Aztec.
So Talik gets his moment. He busts out the fucking laser disc gun. The CD gun. He hits Smith with it. And Smith, like, sells the shit out of it. Right. But it doesn't.
Well, first, Smith can't shoot because, of course, he's a pussy. He doesn't know how to operate the gun. Yeah. Because they have a safety on it. Call back to Big Trouble in China. Safety.
Yeah. Good call.
And apparently, there's, like, four settings. They're all the same, by the way. But there's four settings on this gun.
Determine how fast it shot out.
Oh, okay.
I put it on X4, buddy.
So there is, like, a semi-automatic and automatic.
Well, that's what he said later in the movie. He says, I put it on four times.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, he gets a glancing blow by the fucking CD disc.
He goes down, and this is where they get it settled again. Smith gets another shot. He lands a shot on fucking Talik.
Talik just disappears in a ball of flames, but it did knock loose his adrenochrome wristband.
Yes.
Because it's held on by Velcro. Even, like, you can have something that important. Don't use Velcro straps.
Yeah, no, I understand what you're saying. Velcro is a technology of the aliens, and so an alien came down and gave us Velcro.
Yes.
So your dad's shoes are actually alien technology. Yeah. Think about that.
Yeah, I know. It's cool.
Every time we fucking...
You guys make fun of me, but, like, I'm, like, ahead of you guys.
You're the hippest of all. Yeah. Like, you're so far ahead. Anytime we do, like, a dad joke, we do the Velcro rip. It's we're actually paying homage to our alien brethren, which this episode is dedicated to.
Because we're probably children of aliens, you think about it.
You think so?
Yeah. Well, let's not get into that.
Oh, okay.
So they go back to Jack's place to lick their wounds. Jack puts a Band-Aid and kisses the boo-boo on Smith's arm. And they're like, we got to go kick some ass, guys. Get my duster. It's like, so they go into the closet.
Jack's closet. Okay, Jack's closet.
Hey, this one actually fits me. It's like a varsity jacket. And then Jack's like, yeah, I wore that when I was in Little League. Why are you keeping your fucking Little League varsity jacket?
I don't know.
He's just living the glory days. Like, again, I peaked at 12.
You know what? That's the better joke. We'll stick with that one.
So they're ready to kick ass. He's got the brand new suede jacket.
They're cocking shotguns. They're cocking dicks. They're cocking pistols. They're doing the Steven Seagal cocking the pistol by pressing on the front of it. That happened. He did that.
And as they're going to leave, Diane's cocking blocking them because she's like, hey, I got my bags. I quit my job. Oh, yeah, baby, we changed our mind. That's not happening anymore. Sucks that you don't have a job anymore, but I got a job to do right now.
So Smith butts in because Diane's trying to talk back. He's like, look, ma'am, I need to explain this to you as an FBI. He gets a fresh one across the face.
Right, because she's obviously intimidated by Jack, so she lets her aggression out on the simp. And he loves it. He's just like, whoo-hoo. He's like,
this simp, the cocking that's happening here, you know Smith's going to be there as a third wheel on their vacation, their fuckation.
Oh, yeah.
And
he's
going to
be filming it.
He's going to be cupping the wall, the door, whatever. He's going to be listening in. He's going to be filming. He's going to be jerking to all of this shit.
So as they're walking out, the white boys are out there with their machine guns.
So they get into the vestibule of his apartment complex. They open fire. It's like, oh, my God, the white boys are back. But then, out of nowhere, fucking, of course, Talik appears.
Well, cops show up first.
Oh, cops show up first?
And this is how I knew it was Houston, because it says Houston police on the thing.
Oh.
And then they start shooting at the white boys and the cops start shooting at each other.
Okay.
That's what you do. You just start shooting.
Well, yeah.
And then Talik shows up, and he
stand
fucking
my ground. Which, by the way, as we've learned at this point, I come in peace as alien for I'm standing my own ground.
Yes, that's the literal translation.
We've learned this from this movie. So, okay, so the police have showed up first, and they say, hey, we're standing our ground, a.k.a. an alien. We come in peace, but we got guns and we're shooting at you.
Talik shows up and kills both of them. He kills the white boys and the cops. Our boys jump into, I think, Jack's car, take off. Talik starts running after him Terminator style.
He gets in his own car first.
Well, no, he chases him first, and then he jumps in the cop car.
Oh, okay.
Jumps in the cop car with the door ripped off because the fat cop, like, knocked the door off when he got shot by the alien go.
And of course, Diane sees Talek in the review mirror, and she's like, "Who is that guy?
Some alien asshole from outer space."
I wish that wasn't how Dolph delivered it, but that's how Dolph delivered it.
I think you had a little too much emotion in
there. Oh, did I?
Read. We get a dull car chase. They go through a mall. They do a fucking Blues Brothers and go through a mall.
Blues Brothers, Invasion USA.
But not as exciting.
It's not exciting at all. Talek's killing some cops along the way. Everything's going wrong. And then a car gets blown up. Talek's back on foot. So our heroes.
They go head for the abandoned Sparks Factory.
Yep. They get some headway here. They go for the first Sparks Factory they can find.
And they go, this is where we're going to have our last stand.
They're going to figure out a place for Smith to hide out to get a clear shot.
Right.
They have the wristband, the adrenochrome wristband. They're like, we're going to leave it here for him in the clearing for you, Smith, to take a crack shot right at him.
Yeah. So Smith's got the high ground. They're all hiding. It's like a factory where like management is, where they can look down on the floor. So they're hiding there. Talek comes in. He senses like something's not off, but he's that sweet adrenochrome.
Oh yeah, and he needs it. And he's fingering it, and he's like, "I'm gonna buy myself a jacuzzi."
And then our boy Smith jumps up.
Oh, it's a battery.
God, it was runs on fucking five, not six, five double D battery.
We're the only planet that uses even number batteries, by the way. Isn't that weird?
But we sell them with odd numbers. That's the thing. It's like hot dogs and buns. What the fuck?
Isn't it the weirdest when a battery company is like, "Hey, we gave you the fifth one for free." And it's like, wait, what?
So the gun is like as limp as fucking his dick. So Talek sees that. He fucking Incredible Hulk jumps into the fucking office that they're in.
Yeah, that was a good jump. I like that. Boop, 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 boop.
That's good.
Yeah.
And but our boy Jack's got a shotgun, so he's like pumping them full of lead.
Yeah, it's very Terminator 2 reminiscent.
Yes. And then they just go, "Let's run." So there's this long-ass catwalk they're running across. There's flammable barrels. Like,
we might as well have been in Face Off, right?
Yes.
Catwalks everywhere.
Yes. No doves, though.
No doves.
They're knocking over barrels full of oil that are there for some reason. And then they're shooting it, explosions. But
they're trying to slow down Talek.
But they're not. He's this Herman Munster in it.
He's doing flips. He has watched Hard Target. I don't know how, but he's watched Hard Target. He's like, "I've got the mullet. All he's missing is fucking earrings and the fucking great name, Chance Bordeaux, who was in our last movie for some reason."
Right. They catch up to Talek catches up to them. There's a little scuffle. He throws Smith off like a balcony onto a car.
Catwalk, yeah.
There's a car for some reason inside this factory.
Why was there a car there? Was it their car?
No, I think it was just a random
car. It was just a random car. I saw a random car. Anyways. So he goes crashing in the car. He's completely knocked out. Talek grabs Diane because that's his leverage now, and he needs... Wait, did he get the wristband back? Yeah, somehow he looked in the wristband, and the adrenochrome vials were not in it anymore.
Right.
That's what it was. It's sad that we come into these episodes without remembering the details, and just remembering the details as we're doing
that's for the listener to do. Do your research.
Yeah, really.
So he's like, "Oh, are you looking for these?" And then he shows up. It looks like it's a chaw spit inside these little vials.
It did look
disgusting. They were vials.
Wait, so he might have been satisfied with just like a spittoon of tobacco backfire.
And then like all of a sudden, like this super scientific alien like goes feral. Like, "Argh, I can't." They have a standoff.
Jump down to neutral ground. Okay.
They're having a standoff. They got guns pointed at each other.
Yes. Jack puts down his guns first, and he starts backing up, and he looks down at a pipe that's like at his nipple level, and it's jagged.
Nothing subtle about this at all. He just stares at this pipe for 5 seconds.
And so he notices that, and then he puts down, he crushes one vial to piss off Talek.
Right.
Then he takes the other three and puts them down like by the pipe. So you're like, what?
This was a horrible plan.
It was awful.
And then he just runs off. He runs away. Talek shoots one of his CDs at him, but he came prepared. How did he have... Was the speaker...
It must have been
in his car.
I have no fucking clue.
Because Jack has the speaker. Apparently, that can stop... That's the only thing that can stop these CD things is a speaker. So it hits the speaker. Talek thinks he's killed Jack, because Jack's like off...
Jack. It punctured the speaker, and then goes, "Oh, I'm dead over here. I don't know what that means, an alien, but oh..." And the alien, Talek, buys it, and he's so excited to get his three vials, and he's fingering, and he's rubbing them on his nipples, because that is the one thing that's consistent across the universe, is that nipple rubbing is pleasurable.
It's universal.
It's universal.
So while he's rubbing his nipples, he's distracted. It's a jack. He does a roundhouse, jumps out of nowhere, roundhouses. Talek's like, this looks like time for a roto-rooter. Shoots off his, like, toilet snake at Jack.
Yeah.
I hear your plumbing's backed up.
Jack is struggling with it. He's, like, wrestling with it.
Yep. And this is a big fish. He can't reel it in. He just can't fucking get it under control. He can't puncture the chest. He can't suck out. He can't infiltrate him with the heroin. So he reels him in. He's like, come over here, boy. This is playing in a Mortal Kombat, which was out at the time, too.
I win.
So he knows two sentences now. He learned, I win. Fuck you, spaceman.
Yeah. Yeah, when I put it in the quotes, it's literally the line from the movie. I win. Fuck you, spaceman.
Jack turns the roto-rooter around, stabs Talek in the neck with it, and then roundhouses him, falls back, lands on that pipe.
At least they sold the pipe and then gave us the pipe.
And then fucking Talek, he's in agony, he's confused. He says the only thing he can say.
I bring you peace.
And you go in pieces, asshole. And then he... What happened? Did he just die? He doesn't explode, does he? Because Aztec exploded. I don't remember.
I don't remember him exploding. I think he just disintegrates.
Well, whatever. He low-panned it.
He low-panned it. He turned to white light and disappeared.
So they all meet up. They all, you know, hey, man, how about we go to Rio and fuck around with Manning?
Yeah.
Sounds like a plan. Freeze frame. That's
freeze
it.
Frame. I don't get any Dolph fans. I don't.
I couldn't. Yeah, if someone said that was my guy, I'd be like, "Have you ever seen any other action movies?"
Yeah, yeah. Dolph, so far, it's been a complete zero. No. Showdown in Little Tokyo was not good.
No.
This movie, not good.
No.
The aliens.
Even.
Well, apparently we had a little bit of an abrupt ending there. I'll get that fixed for next week. But the important information is to know we're doing Bloodsport 2 next week, and then. Keep it warm.